Dakota State wins the Division I football championship.
The modern era gold standard for an FCS startup program clashes with the latest and greatest in that same mold. And a pair of undersized superstars lead the way as Big South Defensive Player of the Year Quinn Backus and his Coastal Carolina squad clash with record-setting quarterback Taylor Heinicke at Old Dominion. What happens when a Chanticleer faces a Monarch? Let's find out next on ESPN3. A sellout crowd on hand, Foreman Field in Norfolk, Virginia. Second round of the FCS playoffs as Coastal Carolina faces the four seed in this tournament, Old Dominion. And here's a look at some of the remaining squads. The top half of the 16 remaining units, the top team, the defending national champ, North Dakota State, facing South Dakota State, New Hampshire out of the CAA, much like Old Dominion against Wofford. And the victor of this game will take on Georgia Southern, six-time FCS national champs, or Central Arkansas. Hey, good afternoon, everybody. I'm John Sadak alongside the Skywalker, former NFL quarterback Jay Walker. And Jay, one team will win the national championship this year in the FCS ranks. They will decide it on the field, a playoff in its truest sense.
That's what it's all about. And this is true postseason football, where every third down opportunity for conversion is huge, and any turnover can end your season. That's what it's all about. Rowdy environment on the road. True postseason football.
And some stars as well to help make it all that more exciting. Quinn Backus leads the way for this Coastal Carolina unit, set a program record, 132 tackles this year.
And Quinn Backus doesn't have a lot of size, but he has a lot of speed, and he puts himself in the right position to make plays. You see, he led the Big South in tackles this season, but importantly for today, the fact is he's going to have to get involved in the pass coverage. You got a team that's going to throw the football like crazy. He's got two interceptions on the year. He's got to be active in the pass protection.
The man who will be slinging it around, Taylor Heinicke, a sophomore who's up for the Walter Payton Award, the Heisman of FCS, leads the country in touchdowns with 35.
Taylor Heinicke is a special talent. Many people thought his freshman year might have been a fluke. Well, he came out in his sophomore season, and he's been phenomenal. He's accounted for over 4,500 yards of total offense, 35 touchdowns in the air. And people know he can throw the football, but I think the key for Heinicke is going to be his ability to extend the play as well as running the football. He rushed for over 500 yards on the season. That's an element that many people don't realize he possesses. And if he can get active running the football today, it's going to be a long day for Coastal Carolina.
Some compare him to Drew Brees, generously listed at about 6 foot tall. The undersized QB, though, has a big-time arm. And his top target, Nick Mayers, the senior. He's closing in on 1,000 yards. If he stays on his per-game average, he'll break that threshold today. One team will break on the field. It's the playoffs on ESPN3.
Division I student athletes have higher SAT and ACT scores than college-bound students.
The number of us receiving diplomas
is at an all-time high.
African-American males who are student athletes
are 10% more likely to graduate.
Still think we're just a bunch of dumb jocks?
You need to do your homework.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes, and just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
It is a gorgeous December day, 58 degrees, football time on this artificial surface at Foreman Field, as the Coastal Carolina Chanticleers will receive to get this second round action underway. It is a sellout crowd. That means more than 20,000 fill this facility in Norfolk, Virginia. Old Dominion in black with the white helmets, and Coastal Carolina and white with the black helmets as Coastal runs it out of the end zone. Trey Henderson. Henderson with a bit of room. Gets his way just short of the 30-yard line. And let's meet the quarterback for Coastal Carolina. He is Aramis Hillary, a senior out of North Augusta, South Carolina, first team all-conference, a transfer from the Gamecock program in the University of South Carolina.
And you see him up close and personal. They list him at 6'1", 205 pounds. Seems a little bit taller, seems a little bit bigger. Well put together young man. Tough to bring down when he decides to run the football with that size.
They'll work out of the gun on first down. Motions Lorenzo Taliaferro. And a handoff on first down. Jeremy Height, the primary back in this four-back attack. And, of course, Hillary, one of the impact players for this Coastal unit.
Yeah, and he's a dual-threat quarterback. He's the type of guy that can beat you throwing the football. But when you talk to Old Dominion, they're more worried about him running the football, which they've got to do. When you talk about Jeremy Height, he's a guy that's got to get it done. You see the total yardage there. Get him the football.
He shattered the program record for all-purpose yardage in a season. As Hillary gets on the corner and gets his target, he finds Matt Hazel. That's right around the marker.
And then for Old Dominion, Chris Burnett, he's an interior defensive lineman. He's got to be able to control the running game inside, stuff the running game up the middle, and force Coastal to run the football on the perimeter rather than into the teeth of the defense.
He led all defensive linemen in the CAA in tackles. That last tackle has Coastal in a third and very short. And work out of the pistol. Motion again from Taliaferro. Blitz shown. And Hillary on the design screen. Only one blocker, but able to slip the first hitter. Lunge forward. Niccolo Mastromateo finds himself the first down to the 40-yard line. A gain of a yard and a half.
Yeah, and this is a big conversion for Coastal Carolina. Coming on the road, you've got to get this first down. Great second effort by Mastromateo, realizing he made the first defender miss, but still did not have enough yardage. Lunged forward and picked up the first down.
Malik Johnson, the tackle, fresh set of downs. Another blitz look. They pick it up well, and Hillary again finds Hazel, who averts his first would-be tackler, gallops the sideline, and finds Old Dominion territory all the way to the 31. That is a gain of 29 yards.
The story for Old Dominion is their defense has been suspect. We know they can score, and why is their defense suspect? Missed tackles. We've seen two already in the football game by the secondary. They're young and youthful in the secondary, not fundamentally sound the way they tackle the ball carrier. They've got to shore that up.
They were only 81st in the country against the pass. This is the four seed in this tournament. Split backfield. And the football off. Taliaferro, the JUCO transfer, out of Lackawanna Junior College. No gain.
You see, that's Caleb Taylor, number 96, stuffing the hole, coming up from his middle linebacker position. So kind of let you know their game plan for stopping the run. Have their act. Their linebackers crowd the line of scrimmage, stay close. So they're thinking stop the run first and then stop the pass second.
He's one of several FBS transfers in this game. Came from the University of Virginia. The former Gamecock Hillary engineering a game-opening drive. They sweep their back. Jeremy Height slips through another tackle. Height second gear. And the secondary spills him inside of the five-yard line. Mark him at the three. Jeremy Height gallops for 28 yards.
Once again, missed tackle. Great play call. They've got him in the right place. This play is sniffed out. You tackle the running back too high, and he makes you pay for it. Discouraging start to this contest for Old Dominion right now, where the question has been defense, and right now you're showing why some people think it's going to be defense that's going to be their Achilles heel in this postseason.
They only allow touchdowns 51% of the time, though, in the red zone. While they cough up yards, they're usually good in this spot. First and goal from the three. Height motions to Hillary's right. They fake as Hillary keeps, falls forward, and scores.
Great individual effort by Aramis Hillary there, calling his own number there. Pulls the ball in the stomach. Missed tackle already in the backfield. That's three on the opening drive that really hurt the Monarchs. Quarterback makes a miss and able to extend to pick up the touchdown.
His fourth rushing touchdown. That is a seven-play, 71-yard drive that took barely more than 3 minutes.
The big play, and that's what happens when folks miss tackles in open space. Generally, the offense is going to make you pay, and that's a great job by Coastal Carolina.
Alex Catron, who won a tough preseason fight for the place kicking duties. Sends this one straight on through. He's only missed two on the year, and Coastal Carolina connects on its first possession of the game for a 7-0 advantage. Aramis Hillary keeping and scoring. Shonta clears up a score. Aramis Hillary, 3 for 3, 40 yards passing, and rushed in the touchdown. Do it all QB, leading the charge for Coastal Carolina, which apparently has a banged up left guard. Kevin Hart was seen a bit woozy walking his way to the sideline. That sideline championed by Joe Moglia, the first year head coach. And here are some of the keys to Chanticleer's success.
Offensively, they must control the line of scrimmage. They cannot be one dimensional. They've got to be able to run and pass. And for defense, they've got to keep everything in front of them. Old Dominion likes to rely on the big play with their wide receivers, make them drive the length of the field in time-consuming drive compared to giving up the big play over the top.
Special teams, a major emphasis of both head coaches. There's Bobby Wilder, head coach of Old Dominion, the only head coach they've known in this modern era. Colby Goodwin, Aaron Evans, the return men. This run back up the far side by Colby Goodwin. Sees him knocked and hit out of bounds. Couple of flags fly for the hit out of play.
Towards the end of that run, it was clear that the return man for Old Dominion was out of bounds on the sideline, and emotions got the best of him.
That's 15 yards from the end of the run. First down, ODU.
The referee, Larry Saunders, today, and here's another look.
Yeah, I mean, you know, normally they say if you're on that white and you hit somebody, they're going to throw a flag for you. He was almost on the green when he was hit, went flying into the bench. Have a seat there, young man.
It was Andre Johnson, the linebacker, getting time on specials. Many starters will play specials by design during the year, and that becomes even more regular when the rosters are trimmed significantly for postseason play. Here's Taylor Heineke's first look, and Old Dominion runs on first down. Only gains about 3. Taylor Heineke, of course, an impact player, perhaps the best player in the country as a sophomore.
Probably he's one of the 3 finalists for the Peyton Award. Talked about him in the open. You'll see how special he is. Antonio Vaughn, one of his go-to wide receivers, along with Nick Mayers. But they've got about 7 wide receivers that will catch passes that are very active.
And here's Heineke's first pass, first down in the process. Tyler McCarthy, the tackle. Nick Mayers makes the catch. Coastal defensively is going to have its work cut out for him.
You can pick anybody in the secondary and say they've got to step up and make big plays. But Dontavius Johnson, the cornerbacks, you know, if he gets a one-on-one matchup versus Nick Mayers, he's got to win and come up with a big play.
14-yard gain on that last pickup. Heinicke hands off again. A little subtlety and style from Old Dominion. That's a gain of three. So the first three plays, a couple of runs for Old Dominion, which leads the country in total offense, leads the country in passing offense, but can run the ball a bit too.
And probably lead the country in plays called per game. They like to get up to the line of scrimmage and get that ball snap with 20 seconds on the clock, on the 25-second clock. Very active in them and high volume, high repetition in terms of number of plays called per football contest.
Hybrid pistol look as Heinicke flushed, saw nothing right side. Hot pursuit, Heinicke showing what he can do with his feet. Quinton Davis, who has some quicks, unable to catch up with him. That's a gain of four. Bobby Wilder has assembled a game plan that he thinks can take down any defense in the country.
Well, their key is they want to make it a shootout. They don't want a low-scoring affair. They're going to score a number of points, and defensively they've got to be able to stop the run to make Coastal Carolina one-dimensional. And I think the running game for Coastal is worried about is their quarterback, Aramis Hillary.
Now you mentioned the amount of plays they run. Bobby Wilder said his goal is to run 85 a game. And here's another bad job of tackling, slipping through three different hits all the way to the 11-yard line.
Bad tackling to go along with aggressive running by Tyree Lee. You're going to wrap him up. Watch his legs. He keeps them going. Churn, churn, churn. They're going all the way. Protect the football. Secure it. Lee's about 5'10", 190 pounds, but he runs with aggression.
21-yard run for the man who began the year as the number three running back, running over a defender.
They come in focusing on the pass, and what do? They hit you out of the pistol formation, full head of steam, and then wham! On the goal line, the collision, almost getting to the end zone, but he made the safety. Pernell Williams pay for that tackle.
So 9 yards on that run, one more needed, but this time spilled. Taken out by Dontavis Johnson, so make it 6 runs and one pass on the drive.
They're trying to establish that they can run the football, which they told us all week, and this looks like it's going to be a cakewalk into the end zone. Good job of coming up by Dontavis Johnson from his cornerback position to make the touchdown-saving tackle.
They need half a yard for a first. Only a couple to hit pay dirt. Snap a little off, another run, and the swarm envelops. Mike McClure leads the way, the second team all-conference linebacker.
And we know that Old Dominion leads the conference in a lot of offensive categories, leads the country. Also, they lead the country in number of times they've gone for it on fourth down. Coach Wilder's very aggressive with offensive coordinator Brian Scott. It'll be fourth and eight, and they'll go for it. That's how much confidence they have in their offensive unit. No surprise to see them here going for it on fourth and one.
This is their 30th attempt on fourth down this year. They convert it 76% of the time.
Keep in mind, they can get a first down with gaining 1 yard. It's not fourth and goal.
Heinicke, end zone, touchdown! Blair Roberts, his 6th TD of the year. The sophomore who tied a program record with 3 in the blowout of Campbell can tie the game if a point after helps him out.
Is that confidence in your offense? 4th and 1 on the 2-yard line, and you call a pass, a drop back pass, no play action. That's called getting the ball in the hands of your best playmaker, and that's Taylor Heinicke, and trusting him to make the right decision.
West Virginia transfer Jared Brown connects on the point after. ODU going against the green, but still finding the end zone. Another TD for the Monarchs. The shootout is on. Second round of the FCS playoffs in Norfolk, Virginia.
All right, let's take a look at how Blair Roberts was able to get so open there to tie up this football game. Miscommunication between the linebackers here, but you're also going to see Blair Roberts line up here, come in, then drift to the back of the end zone. They try to pass him off. Miscommunication makes him that wide open in the end zone. You can't do that at this point during your season. We've got a shootout underway, as you said, John.
And the chutzpah, as you talked about during the break, after a run, dominant drive, 7 of the 9 plays were on the ground. Go to the air and drop back on 4th down and 1.
4th and 1, drop back pass, not even a rollout or a bootleg, a pure pass selection. Gutsy call, high risk, high reward.
Trey Henderson, high reward from his own 8, slips through a tackle. To the 45 and another hit out of play. We've seen laundry fly, and we have seen tackles miss terribly on both sides.
Poor tackling. You can see right now the bully effect right now. They're trying to see who can control the schoolyard playground right now. You want to hit one of our guys late, we'll hit you late. Neither team seems to be backing down early in this football game.
That was a 36-yard run back, plus what will likely be a 15-yard penalty. We await word from referee Larry Saunders. These are two teams that draw quite a bit of penalty on the year. Coastal Carolina was 2nd in the Big South at 46 yards per game. ODU led the CAA at nearly 80. Here's the word.
Face mask on the defense. That's 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
I see the face mask. I saw that there, but what about the late hit? I mean, there was clearly a late hit on the sideline. They should have been assessed 2 penalties on this one. You've got to call both ways, and you're going to see a face mask. The head's turned. He's got the face mask. He's on the white. Oh, wow. How do you not call a penalty on that late hit when he was on the green portion of it there? Old Dominion got away with one. But Coastal Carolina, great return, and they got more yards. They've got great field position.
Bobby Wilder said, though, he knows they're going to commit penalties. He wants his team playing fast at all times, and he knows that could be a consequence of it. Some extra protection and then a little bit of trickeration. As the deception is Marcus Whitener, read brilliantly by Old Dominion. He'll lose a yard.
Great job with outside force by number 12, Craig Wilkins, the outside linebacker, the leading tackler on this team with 77 tackles for the Monarchs. He didn't get the tackle there, but he forced the play to go back to the inside, minimizing the gain, or actually resulting in a loss for Coastal.
Second team all-league performer. Keeper for Hillary. He ducks quickly and dives at around the 38. It's a gain of 5.
As we said earlier, I really believe the running game for Coastal is going to be Dermis Hillary. You know, how do they find ways to get him on the edge, allow him to attack the perimeter defense of Coastal Carolina? They're pretty stout up Old Dominion Park. They're pretty stout up front with Chris Burnett. Where you can have some success is running towards their defensive ends.
Let's see on 3rd down. They need 5. Hillary, pocket collapsing. Tries to make something out of nothing. Spins and slips through 3 different would-be hitters. Gets to right around the marker. It looks like he may be half a football shy.
Yeah, poor tackling once again, and we've talked about it, but Hillary, he's a big guy. I told you he was put together nicely. Not easy to bring down. You cannot arm tackle a strong quarterback that's got athleticism and size to go along with it. Great run by Hermes Hillary to make it 4th and 1 and give his team an opportunity to go for it on 4th down.
And they'll go big and bring on Craig Wyke at tight end.
They got to make sure they get this play offense. Already down to 5 seconds on the play clock.
And they'll have to burn a timeout. Coastal could not get personnel in, and as a consequence, could not get set and get the playoff in time.
30-second timeout.
And Joe Moglia, the first-year head coach, he's a finalist for the Eddie Robinson Award is the FCS Coach of the Year. He'll talk things over on his sideline. We remind you that ESPN College Football is available live anytime, anywhere on your computer, tablet, or smartphone at watchespn.com and with the Watch ESPN app.
Today you're watching what appears to be video game football. Jay, I think I've hit the juke button like five times in this game.
Yeah, it's going to turn down who's got the most energy in their turbo button boost in the fourth quarter at this rate. But right now, I think Coach Bobby Wilder has this game going the way he wants it to. He's got a team that's going for it on fourth and one. In situations like this, it's setting up to be the shootout. He feels he's got more bullets than Joe Moglia has with his Coastal Carolina team.
Dramatic change of formation with double tight. ODU stacks the box. Motion from Hazel. After the hard cadence, the fade. Picked off! They wanted Hazel. Old Dominion knew that was coming, and they turn him over.
And that's what you don't want. Now you're allowing Old Dominion to get you to play their type of football.
Reggie Owens with the pick.
I think you got to run the football in this situation here. Fourth and one, but you start off thinking yourself, trying to get the big play on a Monarch team, and then all of a sudden your offense doesn't put points on the board. Now Old Dominion has football, and if they can score, they can take the lead. But to the credit of Coastal Carolina, that interception at that point, that's better than a pooch punt. You know, they've got the ball down inside the 10-yard line, so if Old Dominion's going to score, they're going to have to drive a long way.
And Heinicke with an empty backfield. Pressure comes. Heinicke Whoa. Goes down. And it looks like they'll mark him at the one. I thought he might have been in the end zone for a safety, but the official marker comes at the 1 yard line. Arthur Kelly leading the way.
Wow, you're very fortunate this is not called a safety. You see Heinicke there. He's in the end zone. He just might have stepped out. They actually got that right. He just stepped out of the end zone with his feet when he was tackled in the end zone.
This Coastal squad that specializes in two-pointers, as a flag flies at the snap, Heinicke over the middle behind his target. Let's take another look.
I mean, look, right at the end, he stepped out of the end zone. What presence to know that he was in the end zone, had a split second to react, took that step, and got both feet forward to get out of the end zone.
On the defense, number 93. That's a 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Offside call on Dominique Whiteside, who has spent time at tight end and defensive end. Well, Coastal Carolina, six times this year has gone for two, six times has converted. Twice has picked off balls during conversion tries and run them back for two, and already had one safety on the young year. But 2 points probably not nearly enough on what is brewing to be a high-scoring game. Heinicke out of his end zone again, a little behind his target. As a consequence, they only get about 2 yards beyond the original line of scrimmage.
Pressure on the quarterback there, getting the ball to Marquell Thomas. But Heinicke doing a good job of standing firm in the pocket in the face of pressure. Old Coastal Carolina brought a blitz from his left side.
Now third down and seven. Empty backfield again for Heinicke. In stark contrast to the run-dominant opening drive. The gunslinger finds an open Nick Mayers, and with that a first down to the 23, gain of 13.
Third down, and you're trying to stop Colson. You got to be looking for Nick Mayers. They lined him up in the slot. How does he get such a free release in the middle of the defense here? Gets around him. Nobody close to him. A safety that's 15 yards away. You got to get up close to Nick Mayers and bump him. He cannot get a free release like that, or else Old Dominion will make you pay.
Now Old Dominion with a fresh set of downs, a new life. Coastal showing blitz up the middle, brings it. And Heinicke goes to the edge and a drop ball. Trying to find Marquell Thomas.
And they're excited about Marquell Thomas, saying he's really starting to step up his game. 24 receptions on the year, but that's just one running before he had the football secured. Incomplete.
Four straight passes by ODU. That one dropped. Heinicke, though, has been slightly off target on this drive. Coastal showing just four down linemen. Heinicke audible slightly. They'll bring a blitz off the far edge. ODU picks it up. And a spin away from a hit. Another first down with huge yardage to midfield. Nick Mayers. Mark him at the 49-yard line. That's a gain of 25.
Well, you saw him talk before the snap of the ball. They knew the blitz was coming from the weak side. He got hit with it once before. They bring the blitz. That's just a hot read. When you're going to blitz linebackers, that means you've got to make tackles in open field, one-on-one coverage. Nick Mayers is going to make you pay run after catch. He averages over 15 yards per catch. He's a game breaker.
Now they're trying to break midfield. Fake the handoff. Heinicke getting chased. He is smooth. He is so smooth to the 44-yard line.
You can fall in love with his passing numbers, but when we talked about the hidden element, he's a better athlete than people give him credit for. Defensive linemen don't have the ability to run him down. So if he sees you, he can outrun you. Get him to the edge in the perimeter. Throws the ball extremely well. And then even when you beat him one-on-one on the offensive line, you can't catch him.
Beat Mike McClure on that last play. It's a handoff and a bit of a zigzag for a gain of about two. Colby Goodwin, the junior out of Hampton, Virginia.
What a good job by this Old Dominion offense. They take over the football, pinned in their own 10-yard line, have the ball on the 1-yard line almost. They avoid a safety. Now they're driving, eating up some clock, and they're now in Coastal Carolina territory.
Mike McClure, that last hit. Linebackers becoming more and more involved. Blitz shown. They bring it. Heinicke gets rid of it. Somehow finds his target in a taut window. First touch for Kirk Spellman, the redshirt freshman. That's a gain of 9.
They're going to have to stop bringing this weak side blitz, because now that Old Dominion's caught on to it, you put a lot of pressure on your guys to cover one-on-one. And if that tackle's not made, Kirk Spellman would have been able to run to the house.
And you talked about the depth of targets. 16 catches for Spellman entering the day, the redshirt freshman. And he is deep in the rotation of an incredible core. And a run for Tyree Lee, a gain of about 3.
So now all of a sudden you're expecting the pass, and then look right here. Watch the seal block right there. Good job. Get a body on a body. That's the crease you're looking for. They don't get credit for running the football, but this is the powerful offense for a reason. Averaging 45 points a game, you don't get that way just by solely throwing the ball. You've got to have a running game to go along with it.
Heinicke in the air. Larry Pinkard gets his first catch, and with that a first down to the 24. That's a gain of 8. We mentioned the scoring. Second in the country to Sam Houston State, your defending national runner-up, by 1/10 of a point per game.
Yeah, it's actually 44.5 to 44.6, give or take an extra point here or there. Whoever missed that PAT, when Jared Brown missed the PAT, he's been perfect this year, so you can't blame it on him.
Heinicke locked left side, doesn't see the pressure from the right. Somehow, his team helps him out. He finds a ton of real estate. This man owns Foreman Field inside of the 5 and a first down. That'll be a gain of 20. For the man who's known for doing it in the air, but he is showing what he can do with his feet.
Well, you've got man-to-man coverage. Nobody accounts for the quarterback in the running game, and Heinicke making him pay.
Almost seems like Old Dominion has 14 players on the field. This first down run gets a couple. Tackle by Mike McClure.
Now, this is where it's going to get tough for ODU. Coastal showed in the last drive that ODU is not going to be able to line up and just pound the ball up the middle once they get the ball inside the red zone, or particularly inside the 5-yard line. They forced Old Dominion to have to pass on fourth down. Now, if you're Old Dominion, I think you make the adjustment and you come out throwing the next three downs.
Second and goal, they'll do just that. Slant, somehow tipped incomplete. Coverage there by the safety, Tyler McCarthy. The crowd wanted interference. Blair Roberts on the route.
And I think, although it was an incomplete pass, I think on third down, you come out and you throw the football again. Coastal's going to have a chance at limiting the Monarchs to just a field goal try. It's going to come right now on third down with their pass coverage. I'd be very surprised to see Old Dominion choose to run the football now.
Tyree Lee is the back. Old Dominion so good in the red zone, scoring 87% of the time, a touchdown 75% of the time, tops in the CAA. Press coverage. Heinicke, left side. Touchdown! And a flag comes out on the opposite side of the field as Mayers made the catch.
Yeah, just a great inside-out route by Nick Mayers. It's going to come back. We see that. But what a great route and great recognition by Heineke, knowing that there was one-on-one coverage with his go-to wide receiver. You're going to see Mayers go in, bounce out, ball thrown. By the time the defensive back was able to make the adjustment, Ladarius Hawthorne, it was too late. Myers stopped and caught what they thought would have been a touchdown, but illegal procedure, third down all over again.
So back Old Dominion up, but in a way, Jay, since they can eat up such chunks of yardage, is this a team that can almost arguably be better stepping back?
Give him more field to work with, yes. Now look at the adjustment now. Now you're going to see this is Mayer down here. They've got double coverage on him. You've got a cornerback up close and a safety behind. So that's bracket covered. Got to go someplace else with the football if you're Taylor Heineke.
Johnson is the corner. Heineke locked in on his top target. Decides to run, calls for a blocker, and dances into the end zone for a touchdown.
The legs of Taylor Heineke. You can fall in love with his passing statistics if you want to, but when it's not there, he can extend the play. And look how effortless he makes this look. A little fake, extend the ball out, touchdown.
14 plays, 92 yards, 5 minutes, 7 seconds. And Heineke from 7 for the score.
Now keep in mind, this is the FCS playoffs. During the playoffs, instant replay is in effect. So I believe right now they're going to take an official review on this to see if Heineke actually broke the plane. He stuck the ball out there, but might have been premature. I got it. This should be a quick one. Coming from that angle there, the foot's on the line. He stuck the ball out in front of him, then pulled it back.
And a point-blank view for our official as well. Here's confirmation.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
So make it another TD for Old Dominion and kick time for Jared Brown.
I think his leg's a little weary. This time of year, start getting a little dead leg. Perfect on PATs, 59. Now it's 60 for 60.
He's made 98% of them on his career. Add another. Old Dominion trailed early, but now doubles up Coastal Carolina. Late stage of the first, Heineke and company are rolling. QB in the air, QB on the ground. They can't stop it. It is the playoffs. Second round thereof. 16 teams remain. 21 points are on the board. Coastal Carolina scored on the game's opening possession, but Taylor Heinicke has engineered two scoring drives. On the last one, 14 plays, 10 were called passes. It wound up being 7 runs, 7 passes due to some breakdowns. And Taylor Heinicke, with his feet on those broken plays, made perhaps the biggest moments.
Yeah, I mean, the highlight, and that's what you want in a quarterback that has the ability to run the football. Stay in the pocket as long as you can, but when you run the football, you want to pick up first downs. And every time he ran the football, he picked up either a first down or a touchdown. That's great leadership from the quarterback position.
Trey Henderson, the return man, as Jared Brown's kick has him just inside of his own 4. Henderson, it's a few blocks, spins through one hit, and gets to the 26-yard line. Coastal Carolina, after that 22-yard return, looking for a second NCAA playoff win, located in Conway, South Carolina, and a pretty recent addition to the football ranks. It's been 10 years as a program, Jay, 5 conference crowns, 3 playoff appearances.
And that's what it's all about. You talk about programs getting it going, and Coastal, so long was known as just a baseball school, great powerhouse there, but can you name a famous alum from Coastal Carolina?
Hit me.
Dustin Johnson, PGA golfer.
Came just short at the Open Championship in England in 2011, tied for 7.
Now there you go. Now you want to take it another level. Okay. I stump you, then you have to give me all the nuggets.
Yeah, they certainly have their share, as Old Dominion has about its entire roster at the line of scrimmage. And Hillary on a first down pass gets a gain of about 8 as he flicks this one out. Finds Chris Presley. Yeah, this Coastal Carolina team has 4 alums in the NFL. Jerome Simpson of the Vikings, one of them. Trips right. On second and short, Hillary brought down in the backfield. Pressure from Caleb Taylor, the Virginia transfer, middle linebacker.
And what they're doing are just linebacker run blitz. You see Taylor shoot the gap. The obvious run situation there. It's the second time today we've seen Caleb make a tackle for a loss in the backfield of Coastal Carolina.
Final seconds of the quarter will tick away. And we'll head on to the second. Coastal Carolina will have a 3rd down and 4 in its own territory when the second gets underway. Schulte clears, have won 6 in a row. They're red hot, but they trail on the road.
NCAA.com/shop has all the hottest officially licensed 2012 championship merchandise. With over 100,000 items for over 500 college teams, everything you need is in one location. You'll get 365-day hassle-free returns, great customer service, and $4.99 3-day shipping on any size order. Remember, for all your college gear, head to NCAA.com/shop.
called by Old Dominion. So after getting the ball on somewhat short notice, ODU calls its first TO of the game. And good afternoon, everybody. I'm John Sadak. He's the Skywalker, Jay Walker, former NFL quarterback. And the quarterbacking today has been creative. We certainly saw that takeaway play an impact in the game, but I think the story so far has been what Heinicke can do from an improvisational standpoint.
Yeah, with his legs. I mean, we know he can throw the ball. He distributes the ball evenly to his wide receivers, big play receiver, and Nick Myers, but the ability to run the football, prolong the play, and keep the chains moving. That's the mark of a good quarterback. What do you want him to do? Get first downs. And for Old Dominion, they just keep putting so much pressure on your secondary. You focus on the wide receivers, and next thing you know, he's hurting you up the middle with a big run.
He is one of three finalists for the Walter Payton Award, the Heisman of the FCS ranks, and he's only a sophomore. Four down linemen. He feels no pressure. Deep ball, left side. Incomplete, Antonio Vaughn. Well, Jay, the question I have for you, only one sophomore has ever won the Walter Payton Award. That was the other Adrian Peterson, the man famous for the run at Georgia Southern. Can Heinicke win it as a sophomore this year?
Tough competition. You know, you got Miguel Mayanot from Stony Brook, who's had a great year. Over 2,000 yards he's accounted for. Normally, that's the formula to get you the Payton Award. But then you've also got Eric Breitenstein, the fullback from Wofford, whose career body of work is going to be tough. And both of their teams are in the postseason. Heinicke's the only quarterback, which goes to his advantage. Maybe the runner split the vote.
Block holds from Kirk Spellman that opens a path for a gain of 8. There are some of the numbers for Heinicke. Perhaps a comparison in a way to what Johnny Manziel is going through, and there are some voters that say no freshman goes on the ballot. Could the same be true of a sophomore in the FCS ranks?
I think so. On this level, I think it can happen. But probably one of the greatest FCS players we've seen in recent memory is Armani Edwards. And he never won it 3 times in a row. He didn't win it until he was a junior. Even though as a sophomore, he led his team to a national championship. I do believe the career body of work may come into play for Breitenstein at Wofford. But I also think because there are 2 running backs in there and you've got 1 quarterback, you know, I always think the tie goes to the quarterback. And normally that's the case with voters as well.
Tyree Lee gets the first down on the ground. Of course, Armani Edwards not only won a national championship, but in that first epic year, beat a top 5 FBS team, beat Michigan in the Wolverines' first ever game against an FCS squad. And that one's certainly part of the downfall of Lloyd Carr. Heinicke out of the pistol. Pressure up the middle. He deals with it so deftly. He slings it out left side. Larry Pinkard, gain of 4.
Yeah, this has got to start becoming frustrating for the Chanticleer defense. They're blitzing their linebackers. You saw Quinn Backus blitz from the middle linebacker position and Mike McClure. So they've tried to blitz Heinicke from his weak side. That last play, they tried to blitz him right up the middle, and they still haven't gotten to him. He's gotten rid of the football. Not only has he gotten rid of the football, he's completed passes. Very frustrating on defensive coordinator.
Here, the quick hitter on the slant right side. That's a first down. The positioning, the timing, the pacing is so perfect. That's why Joe Moglia calls them an offensive juggernaut. That's a gain of 9.
I mean, they've got weapons. And he gets rid of the ball quickly, makes great decisions. And then your defense just takes one play off defensively, and they make you pay.
8 for 11 today. In his postseason career, 11 TDs, no picks. And, of course, he has one on the ground today. He has another completion, perhaps a first down, depending upon the spot. He'll have him right around the marker.
Taylor Heinicke pass complete to Blair Robinson.
Now for Coastal, don't get upset right now. Don't get anxious because they're taking what you're giving them defensively, and don't decide you're going to get aggressive and try to blitz. Make them move the ball down the field. So often when a team starts hitting that hitch route, you have a tendency to want to move your cornerbacks up.
And off on second and inches. Well, more than enough for a first down. Quinn Backus behind the ball carrier after a gain of 8 inside of the 10. Tyree Lee.
And they do a good job of allowing Lee to run with momentum towards the line of scrimmage. Another pull there, this time by the center, Josh Mann.
And Tyree Lee and AP Player of the Year in the state of Virginia, which is known for its football. Lee set the Eastern Region record with over 2,500 yards. Heinicke on the pump. Heinicke on the corner. Touchdown!
The wide receiver corps for Old Dominion gets so much attention from the defensive secondary that if the defensive line does not keep Heinicke in the pocket, there's nobody to account for him. See, they're so worried about the pass receivers, which you have to be, but once he gets past the D-line, there's nobody there. And you can't catch him with the defensive lineman. By the time the linebackers come over for help, it's too late. This is like stealing. Right now, Taylor Heinicke's having fun on the football field.
Jared Brown converts short field thanks to a pick. 9 plays, 48 yards, 2 minutes, 31 seconds. It's a 21-7 lead for the 4-seed Old Dominion. Old Dominion 21-7. Old Dominion leads Coastal Carolina in this second round FCS playoff game. Coastal Carolina scored on its first drive, but interceptions and the last couple, and Old Dominion with some short field starting to pull away. Taylor Heinicke getting hydrated. Some chatter around this field was about how many pass attempts Old Dominion would have today. Heinicke showing his versatility, though. It's not all about the air. Henderson, who's had some good run backs on kick return, gets nothing here. Stung at the 19. Well, Kansas State's fantastic regular season comes to a close with a must-win finale in Manhattan. Colin Klein of the Wildcats look to secure a Big 12 title and automatic BCS bid against Case McCoy and the Longhorns. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows 8, number 18 Texas versus number 6 Kansas State tonight at 8 on ABC, part of Championship Week.
Colin Klein, once upon a time, almost a shoo-in, front runner for the Heisman Trophy. Now he's still playing for a piece of hardware.
Hand off to Jeremy Height. Height keeps his legs churning to the 23, gain of 3. Here's a look at what Coastal Carolina has done so far.
Yeah, I mean, they came off, used a game plan. Hillary was able to mix it up with running pass and then the 2 interceptions. So now all of a sudden, I think this is a breaking point for Coastal Carolina. I mean, offensively, they've got to catch up. The defense hasn't shown the ability to stop ODU. They've got to get some first downs, eat up some clock, and put some points on the board. Tempo of this game right now is favoring Old Dominion. They wanted it to be a shootout. It is a shootout, but right now Coastal Carolina's only got 7 points on the board. And the one thing I know that Coach Mobley did want to have to do was rely on his offense to have to score time and time again. If they don't score on this possession with the way ODU's going, this game can be over by halftime.
And part of the problem is that Coastal is a balanced team that runs the ball quite a bit. 6-game win streak, 7 straight games with 200 yards or more on the ground. They haven't had that luxury today due to Old Dominion's pressure on offense and defense. They stunt, rushing four. And somehow the QB makes a play. To the 30 goes Hillary. That's a first down, gain of six.
Hillary, when given the chance, he showed the desire to get it done. Nothing there in the secondary. Watch him just run and look for it, make a guy miss. Start to spin before he gets to the defender. Not a good idea to turn your back to a defensive player that's getting ready to hit you, but just enough to pick up the first down.
Pistol time and trips to his left. They blitz one, but the wrong gap. And Height has some real estate as he gets stumbled at his ankle down to the Old Dominion 43-yard line. 27-yard run.
That's what you have to do versus Old Dominion. And this is a team that gives up almost 160 yards rushing per game, just under 400 yards total offense. You know at some point if you force feed the run, they're going to miss a tackle, and you can gouge them for a big play. If you can stay close in this football game, you can run the football on Old Dominion.
Coastal, though, is not used to trailing like this. Tip ball as pressure came, incomplete. They set a Big South record. They won five straight games during a smaller portion of their recent win streak by 20 or more points.
They got hot at the right time. Take a look here. This is a hot read by the quarterback, just trying to get the ball to his wide receiver when he recognized the blitz. But good job by Alex Arena leaving his feet to tip it. But Coastal, you know, getting in was no shoo-in. I mean, they received the automatic qualifying bid from the Big South Conference, but there was a three-way tie between Liberty, Coastal, and Stony Brook, and they got the AQ because in the Big Sky Conference, all predicated on who has the best road victory during the year.
So he throws a little behind his target, but Mastro Mateo showing incredible body control, backpedaling in full stride, makes the catch, comes down clean after a gain of 24.
Great job by Mastro Mateo. We talked about the readjustment that he made on the football. Ball behind him, turned his body completely to the defense, secured the football, and made the catch.
Well, that is an Olympic athlete type of play. Mastro Mateo, transfer from Southern Methodist. He's a 4.0 GPA as a philosophy major. Nietzsche and Superman would be proud. Hand off to Jeremy Height. Plunges to just beyond the 15, gain of four.
Just to go back to that point of why Coach Moglia thought his team could come in here and win. Because in order to get in, the Big South Conference judges by who's got the best road victories, best road win-loss record in the conference. They went undefeated on the road this year, which was big for them, and they figured we can go on the road again and get another victory. And they went down to Daytona Beach and beat Bethune-Cookman last week, so they're not getting caught up in the atmosphere. And right now they're doing a great job of responding offensively.
That was the first playoff win in program history as Hillary off his back foot nearly gets picked. That was a force looking for Akeem Wesley.
Kitchen sink blitz on Hillary forced him to throw the football. Old Dominion brought everybody they could that wasn't responsible for pass coverage on the blitz. Hillary just had to get rid of that football. Very fortunate it was not intercepted.
Third down time. They've gone 66 yards on eight plays. They need six for a first. Height becomes a receiver. Empty backfield. A dump to Height. First down, touchdown. Make that Matt Hazel, the team's top target. All-conference performer, his seventh TD of the year.
They dialed up. They had what they wanted. It was man-to-man coverage. So they called the wide receiver screen, and they sent a guy in motion to block the guy that was playing bumper run coverage on the defender, forcing him to go around. And great execution by the offense from the Chanticleers.
And the good news for Coastal Carolina, Hillary and company, they're within a score, point after pending. But Old Dominion's offensive machine is one that tends to keep rolling. Alex Catron converts, nine plays, 71 yards, 3 minutes and 14 seconds. And now 14 points for the best of the Big South. It's a one-score game. Second round of the playoffs in Norfolk.
21-7, Coastal Carolina makes it just a one-score game. But let's take a look at that touchdown by Matt Hazel. Great execution. You're going to see the matchup here. This is Hazel, bump and run man-to-man coverage. So what do? They send Jeremy Height to come out and actually block the defensive back. When he does that, that allows Hazel to shoot the gap and get the touchdown here on the screen. You see that? Hazel's going to go block him, throws the ball. You can do that if the ball's thrown behind the line of scrimmage. That freed Matt Hazel to score the end zone, but a great job by Jeremy Height with the execution of the rub block to spring him free for the touchdown.
And that is the giving nature of so many of these players. Height, second team all-conference running back, glad to block, but here a wobbling kick goes out of bounds and flag comes out for the penalty.
And you're playing with fire, and that fire is that Old Dominion offense. You don't want to give them better field position. They've already shown they can go 90 plus yards to score. You can't have your kicker kick it out of bounds on the kickoff after you scored.
Especially when both teams, Jay, emphasize special teams so much, and it's a mantra for both squads. You must be a special team star.
Kick out of bounds on the kicking team. We'll all be placed to the 35-yard line. First down.
Have to be a star in specials before you can play in the game, and ODU indeed has done it from midfield and the entire field.
Yes. If I say when you're playing with fire, you want to try and win the battle of field position. Do not give the home team offense any type of advantage. But sooner or later, if you're Coastal Carolina, and if you're a fan of the Chanticleers, you've got to think our defense has got to show up and make a stop sooner or later. You don't think a team's going to go there and continue to score every single possession. Defensively, they've got to find a way to keep this, to get this Old Dominion offense off the field.
And that's the task for Clayton Carlin, the defensive coordinator for the Chanticleers. Play fake. Heinicke with all day. And he wisely throws it away, had nothing there. And Clayton Carlin learned under Jack Brank in high school. His high school coach visited practice this week. But his first two college coaches, Bill Manlove at Delaware Valley, Hall of Famer, won two D3 titles at Widener, former president of the American Football Coaches Association, and some guy named Tom Osborne. Do you know him?
Tom Osborne is in Nebraska?
Something like that. Somewhere
in
the Midwest.
College Hall of Famer?
Yeah, that guy.
Congressman Tom Osborne.
He was a grad assistant under Tom Osborne at Nebraska. Heinicke, a bit of a wobbly, ugly duck, is incomplete. Looking for ball. Old Dominion out of the Colonial Athletic Association. For now, Jay, they're going to Conference USA. This is their last year at the FCS level. It's only their fourth year of football.
They've had tremendous success. High-powered offense, great fan base. Right now, the moment of truth for Coastal Carolina. You've got them at 3rd and 10. Can the defense finally make a stop against this high-powered Monarch offense?
Heinicke looked mortal on that last play. They only rush 4. Heinicke stepping up, one-on-one! First down! Catch made at the 40. That's a gain of 24 yards for Nick Mayers.
This is confidence in Nick Mayers there. Heineke's going to buy time, one-on-one coverage, very good coverage, but they've got that chemistry between the quarterback and the wide receiver. He threw the ball behind him. Great job by Ladarius Hawthorne. And now makes a great adjustment for the ball to come up with the first down.
Is there a little bit of a shove there, Jay?
If you get called for it.
Deep ball off the back of a Chanticleer. Dontavis Johnson was entirely focused on Vaughn, the target. Had a clank off the rear of his helmet shoulder pad.
He's in the trail position. He sees the reaction of the wide receiver and leaves his feet. Very fortunate that ball was underthrown just a tad. Right now, Coastal Carolina, you see the defense is starting to show chips in the armor. The key is to keep everything in front of you. Do not allow these wide receivers to get behind you. And right now, Old Dominion's trying to utilize the vertical passing game.
Heinicke, who started 10 of 13, is 1 of 4 on the drive. Make it 1 of 5. That one woefully short of Mayers, who curled back open.
Yeah, they're having fun right now. They realize that Coastal's going to stop blitzing, and they're trying to play man-to-man coverage without bringing pressure. So if you're Taylor Heinicke, you're saying, well, where's my best matchup? That's going to be Nick Mayers, and he just missed on that route. I'm surprised at the amount of man-to-man coverage that they're playing. cover two, man-to-man across the board. Dangerous.
Giving a lot of space here, too, on this third and 10. Incomplete. Up in the air with the right hand of Mayers. Had some contact with the DB in the process.
Fourth and 10, this part of the field. This is where Old Dominion will probably do a pooch punt. Taylor Heineke's got a little pretty active leg, and they say if you see Heineke start off at 5-6 yards and drop back 1 yard to get to 7, expect the pooch punt.
Coastal does. It has one man back at the 20, but Old Dominion is going to call timeout. So if the Monarchs call timeout, Jay, you have to think they're going to go for the first down, right? Otherwise, snap and kick.
I think they're actually going to punt them. I think they call the timeout to see if Coastal makes the adjustment and has a return man back there. And I think because the Chanticleers had somebody on return, they decide, okay, we don't have enough time to get our punt unit out there. Let's go ahead, call timeout, and bring it up more accurate, use our punter, maybe for a directional kick to try and pin Coastal.
So they only have one timeout left as we take a look around the world of the FCS, defending national champ. North Dakota State takes on South Dakota State. New Hampshire out of the CAA facing Wofford. At last check, Wofford a 7-0 lead. That's late stage of the second quarter. Georgia Southern up 21-6 on Clint Conk and Central Arkansas, the former Division II program. That's in the early stage of the second quarter.
How about North Dakota State? The Bison. Rob Jensen, the quarterback, comes back for an opportunity to try and lead them to back-to-back FCS titles.
Pressure shown. Punt gets off and great hang time. Fair catch called for, but it'll go into the end zone. So they called a timeout, and still it'll be a touchback. Jonathan Plisco is one of the nation's top punters, but that's only his 26th punt of the year. The offense has been so good, he hasn't had a chance to kick all that much.
I mean, he didn't qualify for all those punting awards that go out there to some of the best special teams players out there. But right now, if you're Coastal, it seems you've got to think, hey, you took the shot. You know, you absorbed the initial blow from Old Dominion with that offense. They put 21 points on you. But now, if your offense can respond, they can either tie this game or make it a little bit close. So give credit to the guys from Conway, South Carolina. They could have given up. The defense figured it out. And if they can score right now, it'd be a good contest.
Well, Chanticleer is a term. It comes from Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. It's a rooster who rules the barnyard with cunning and wit. His competitiveness never wanes. He battles to the end. Well, Chanticleer, Aramis Hillary trying to do just that, but on his series of jukes, gets maybe a yard.
I'm glad you gave me some explanation, because the mascot kind of looks like a Hokie.
Does a little bit.
So I was, you know, trying to figure out, was it a Hokie, a Chanticleer, but you being the man, the studious person that you are, came up with the correct definition.
Well, Chanticleer, according to legend, uses his brains to come out on top every time. And here it's the brawn of the ground game to the 25 for a gain of 5, and Chanticleer a little banged up in the process. Take a look at some of the other scores around the FCS ranks. Illinois State led App State 7-0 in the second quarter. Mountaineers have tied that one up.
That's an interesting one in Georgia Southern. Now they were struggling early with Central Arkansas. Now they're starting to take control in that contest. The winner of this game will take on the winner of that Central Arkansas-Georgia Southern game.
Well, I have a question for you, Jay Walker.
Yes.
Old Dominion, the self-professed greatest startup FCS program, draws a lot of comparisons, understandably so, to Coastal Carolina, which did it effectively in the last 10 years. But I would argue Georgia Southern is the gold standard. Dormant football program cast aside after World War II. And Georgia Southern came back in 1982 by its fourth-year football under the legendary Irk Russell, won its first of an FCS record 6 national championships, and now both programs are going to the FBS ranks.
Well, I mean, if you're judging it by championships, of course, Georgia Southern, but I'm judging by this environment, consecutive sellouts.
Third down for the Chanticleers, who have their first FCS playoff win. They look for a second, and In the process, they find a first down to the 38-yard line. Gain of 13 to Hazel. You saw the comparison of the Chanticleers. How about the Eagles out of the Southern Conference? They've gone back to that triple option, spread option attack. Tracy Ham and the Ham Bone champion back in the big days.
You know about the Ham Bone.
Tracy Ham, a legend who went on to the Canadian Football League as Jeremy Hite loses a yard.
Keep in mind the last graphic show Old Dominion with one CAA conference title. They would have won the conference title this year, but because they're going to Conference USA, they were ineligible for the CAA conference title and the automatic bid to the postseason. So you could put an asterisk and say they won two conference titles, but tremendous success for Bobby Wilder here in Norfolk, Virginia.
On second down, Hillary wrapped up and brought down. No gain on the play. Chris Burnett, first team all CAA.
Burnett, the strength of this defensive line. Big number 90 right there. You just got to hold your ground. Hold your ground, shed a block. And that's what you do. Once a quarterback tries to take off, you throw your offensive lineman to make the tackle. That's how you do it. Big senior from Baltimore, Maryland.
Proud product of the Gilman School. Third down. Both teams have been effective. Hillary with some modest pressure. Has all day. The dump. First down.
And then some.
Weaving his way. Inside of the five. Jeremy Hite. The release screen is big play in a big way.
I mean, Hite showed you he can block and he's played well. You're going to see him just sneak out of the backfield. Great job by Hillary to recognize him over the pass rush. And then the end of this run, this is all just Jeremy Hite spinning Calvin Powell, the free safety for Old Dominion, around like a top.
He had 188 receiving yards on the year, entering today 59 on that one play. That's where heroes can be made in the playoffs. They fake the handoff. Hillary on the keeper, 2 yards short. After a gain of a couple.
Wow, what a big play. By Jeremy Hite to run after catch yards. Gutsy performance being shown on display here by Coastal Carolina.
Second and goal. They fake it again. Hillary keeps, and again he's stuck. This time gets a yard.
One of the problems I've always had with the spread offense is anytime you've got your quarterback taking shotgun snaps on the 2 or 3 yard line, that ball has to go backwards before it goes forward. I just think if you get a quarterback you can put under center, the threat of the run game becomes more viable.
After that hit by Nate Barnes, they indeed go under center. Will he slide over center? He'll try to. First effort, no. Second and 30, short.
I thought he got in. Wow. Close one. You know, the problem you have there is that became obvious that they were going to try the QB sneak from about a yard out. This looked a little uncomfortable. The key is getting low. You got to get low. He got one step high. No, he did not get in. That's a great shot there. You can tell. What a great stop by Old Dominion to stand him up. So often you've got these kids in high school now that have never taken snaps underneath the center. They don't realize it. Key with a quarterback sneak, you got to snap that ball and stay low. The moment the defense stands you up, you lose that battle.
So a timeout called by Joe Moglia, awaiting the 10th play of this drive. Joe Moglia, who coached at Fordham, Lafayette, Dartmouth from 1968 until 83, and then took a hiatus where he became chairman of the board for Ameritrade, a role he still handles. Occasionally has to fly away from the team to attend board meetings in Nebraska.
Well, I can guarantee you didn't take a pay cut when he left college football. But now he's back, and it's that passion. I mean, give him credit for the job he's done there to have them in the postseason play. They got their first victory.
And so you step away from the game, and you go to Merrill Lynch, TD Ameritrade CEO, chairman of the board. And by the way, he makes nearly $200,000 as the head coach.
Not bad being Joe Moglia, particularly when your football team is winning.
That's the American dream. And the American game with its biggest play. Fourth down, goal to go. Hillary on the edge, end zone, Hazel, touchdown.
Wow, he got away with a push off. Great job by Matt Hazel. They did a good job of snuffing out this design pick play. Look at that. Look at your shot to clear.
That fighting rooster.
Well, take a look. Right before the catch was made, Hazel got that little bit of separation he needed with a little push off there on the defensive back. I guess they're going to review whether or not he was inbound. Can't review a pass interference call. That was not called.
That was a 10-play, 80-yard drive, 4 minutes, 6 seconds, 14-yard TD. What do you think?
Yeah, I guess the key is, did he secure the ball cleanly? I thought he did. It was a clean catch. That's the push. And then you see the catch. He's got the ball.
After further review,
the
ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
And I don't have a problem with the replay use, and if it takes a little time from the game, as long as you get the call right. You know, you want the game to be called on the field, and you want the correct call to be made. So if they want to review all the touchdowns and plays to make sure, no problem with it at all.
Here is the swinging gate. Chanticleers are known for, from time to time, going for it in situations like this. Austin Kane, the holder, in the fluorescent cleats of Alex Katrin out of Apopka, Florida. And his right-footed effort is true. Tie game. Coastal led it, 7-0. ODU left out to a two-score lead. We're deadlocked in the second round of the playoffs. All, second round of the FCS Championship from Norfolk, Virginia. John Sadak and former NFL quarterback Jay Walker with you. Coastal Carolina, 10 plays, 80 yards, 4 minutes, 6 seconds. Aramis Hillary, that man, found Mr. Hazel in the end zone. Tie game, and Jay, we talked about it during the break. What spirited effort and confidence by this Coastal team.
Yeah, right when it looked like they were going to get blown out of the water, the defense came up with their first stop, and then the offense responded to tie up this football game. Great job by the kids from right outside of Myrtle Beach.
Here the kick return by Goodwin. Gets to the 34. It's a return of 20. And we'll see what Taylor Heinicke can do on this possession after looking brilliant in his first three drives. He was very mortal, missed on 5 of 6 passes to several wide-open targets.
Yeah, and what Coastal has done is they've come out with more man-to-man coverage than I think he was prepared to see. When you're going to play man-to-man coverage, you've got to be extremely accurate with the football as a quarterback. And because he was not, that's why they were able to get the stop. Now, it'll be interesting to see if Coastal continues to play the aggressive man-to-man coverage that they started to play there in the last drive.
Might they go back to the ground? They will on the first play. In a big way, first down. Into Coastal territory. Tyree Lee, 38-yard line.
Just looking for a crease, and I think Old Dominion not in a hurry to try and score some points and run the offense, and you're just going to see a crease, wide open space, and he just cuts across the grain for the big yardage gainer.
28 yards, so why not go back to him? This time off right tackle, fumbles the football. Looks like ODU jumped down upon it at the 35.
Well, something you'll notice about Old Dominion, their offensive line, they take big splits. You know, normally you tell somebody to get 12 inches apart, they're using like 18-inch splits, which really opens up the lanes for the running game.
This is a pretty large offensive line, but it's also a lean one. Heineke, quick hitter right side, first down, and more. Touchdown! Blair Roberts, 35 yards.
Blair Roberts is one of the larger wide receivers on this Old Dominion roster, and he showed you how to use your size right there. 6'2", 190 pounds. What do you do? Show the speed to the outside, then put a nice move with a stiff arm, kind of a foot race. Great individual effort by Blair Roberts for his sixth touchdown grab of the year.
Well, he's got two today. Old Dominion, four plays in a minute and 5 seconds. Extra point. The Monarchs look like one of the common folk, but it's more imperial after that charge down the field.
And this is just Roberts just making it happen. Takes a hitch route. Poor angle by Ladarius Hawthorne. Safety comes over. He misses a tackle. Blair Roberts just made the secondary of Coastal Carolina look foolish.
The size and speed of this team, amazing. And he's one of the rare imports on a squad that's dominated by Virginians. He is from Rochester, New York. But so many are from the Commonwealth of Virginia. It's for lovers and football players. Taylor Heineke and company enjoying a lead yet again.
We've got once again Old Dominion trying to create some separation on the scoreboard. Can Coastal on offense answer again? Another scoring drive by the Monarchs. One thing I will say for Coastal Carolina, they have had success in their special team return game. Each time they've kicked off to Coastal Carolina, the return game has been on point. Would not be surprised if you saw a big return here set up by Coastal Carolina.
Jared Brown's kick. Trey Henderson, full name of Latravian. He prefers Trey.
Oh, wow.
Forced to sidestep out of bounds.
And that's what you can't do.
An ACC title and a place in a BCS bowl game is on the line tonight on ESPN. Senior quarterback E.J. Manuel and the Seminoles look to punch their ticket to the Orange Bowl with a victory over Tevin Washington and the Yellow Jackets. The Dr. Pepper ACC championship game, Florida State versus Georgia Tech tonight at 8 on ESPN. Also on live, watch ESPN. It's part of Championship Week.
This is what you don't want to do when you're fielding a kick. Catch the ball and take a step out of bounds inside your own 15-yard line. You're better off just letting the ball bounce and go out of bounds, and you get the ball at the 35-yard line. Big mental error.
So here with tougher field position, handed off to Marcus Whitener. One of his few touches early, gets a gain of 4. E.J. Manuel, the name we mentioned, was one of those Heisman candidates once upon a time. He has a tie to this game. One of Old Dominion's cornerbacks, T.J. Cowart, number 22, once picked off E.J. Manuel 3 times in a high school game.
Yeah, as I said, I know E.J.'s from here, but I didn't know it was going to be that negative effect of 3 interceptions by a D.B.
Another poor job of tackling as DeMario Bennett, South Carolina transfer, makes the catch. They can't imagine that Manuel had many bad days in high school.
The number one rated high school quarterback in the land. When he came out of high school.
There's such amazing pedigree in the Hampton Roads 757 areas. Hand off to Height. Gets about three. How about names like Bruce Smith, Michael Vick, Lawrence Taylor? That's football alone. Baseball, David Wright, Ryan Zimmerman, Alonzo Mourning, AI on the basketball floor. It's a who's who of athletes.
You mentioned AI. You can mention him for basketball and football. He was a state player of the year in football as a junior.
Second down. Many of the men that are on this field.
Look at this. Nobody beyond 8 yards from the line of scrimmage right now. You've got to be anticipating the blitz.
Hillary gets to the edge. Containment holds. Throws it away. Hey, you're right, Jay. Nobody was recessed beyond the first down mark.
Yeah, they were showing you that they were bringing the blitz. And you know, as a quarterback, what you want to do is if you know a team's going to blitz you, you got to make them pay. What you don't want to do is just throw an incomplete pass, because then they're going to bring that blitz again and feel comfortable. You've got to go right after the defense, wherever they're bringing the pressure from, substitute with a hot read, get a completion, and that'll keep them off your back for a while.
Split backfield for Hillary. They get a little more depth with the safeties. Hillary, middle, first down and more. Beyond midfield, Niccolo Mastromateo, he somehow finds a way to get open every time they need that big conversion.
Yeah, you're going to see Mastromateo just come across the screen from right here, getting to that second hole. Great throw by Hillary. Hitting him in stride to pick up the first down.
26-yard completion as ODU stacks the box. Back pressure, rushes forward. Screen is open left. Hillary doesn't see it. He goes down to the 48. That's thanks to number 48 on the pressure up the middle, Preston Smith.
Preston Smith on the left side just comes on the inside. Hillary thinks he sees a runaway. Close very quickly. Smith delivers a sack.
Second and 13. Separation again for Mastromateo. That's a tough ball with defenders much larger on either side.
And that's the matchup that they're going to. He made that throw into a tight window. Adjustment was made by Craig Wilkins to run with him a little bit deeper, the outside linebacker, but that ball was just perfectly thrown. And give credit to Coastal Carolina. They realize they're getting the matchup that they want. That's right here. Anytime you got Mastromateo lined up against a linebacker, they're trying to feed him the football.
Under a minute to go in the half. After that 19-yard completion, Hillary doesn't feel backside pressure. Or maybe he did as he throws that away. His ODU team beginning to show a little bit of gas. Eric Saylor, in the end, gasping for breath, I should say, after that run.
Right now, Miss Hillary, you've got to think, okay, scoring a touchdown is nice, but we've got to protect the football, and if we have to settle for a field goal, we're still within striking distance at the half, less than one score. Secure the football. Don't take any unnecessary risk with it when you try and throw.
Locked left side, throws left side. Spin out of the first hit, roll out of the second. Inside of the five. Matt Hazel to the three.
These teams are going at it right now, John. I mean, the athleticism is showing on the offensive side of the ball. Matt Hazel, the go-to wide receiver for Coastal Carolina, catches it. Good move inside, then back outside, making a guy miss, almost scoring a touchdown. It's a big-time play from Matt Hazel, the junior from Augusta, North Augusta, South Carolina.
28 yards on that play. Some huge chunks of yardage in individual plays during this drive. Long cadence. With the play clock at three, Hillary.
Yeah.
That flag flew as Hazel was tied up. Eric Lewis was in coverage.
So they do a good job of putting three wide receivers on the right and one-on-one on the backside. Hazel's trying to get away and being held and pushed.
Referee Larry Saunders.
Holding on the defense, number 26. The foul was against an eligible receiver It's an automatic first down, half the distance to the goal.
Now the good thing for Coastal in this situation is that they've got that one timeout. So that means they can run the football, then call a timeout, get another playoff to get their field goal unit on the field.
Pistol look, Jumbo. Height, the running back. Gets the ball. And is short. Flag comes out, though. Extra contact way after the play.
Well, unfortunately, you see Height limping off the field after the carry. They've got him. They slam him down after the whistles. And it's specifically for that. Now you've got Height, who got injured on that play, limping over to the sideline. Oh, that's costly. And I think Old Dominion is going to be called for the penalty, but because of the time situation, it's not going to hurt them too much. If you're Coastal, you're very limited in what you can do offensively.
After the play, personal foul on the defense, unnecessary roughness. That's half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
So now the decision comes, do you go for it or do you take the field goal?
Timeout, Coastal Carolina, their final charge timeout of the half. 30-second timeout.
This is another look here. Good surge, but good strong resistance by Old Dominion. A little bit short. And then the penalty will move them that much closer. So they only need about 4 inches to tie up this football game.
Carvin Powell and Caleb Taylor. Taylor had him underneath. It looked like Powell was the more forceful up high, throwing that man, Jeremy Height, down to the earth. Jay, I think if you're this close, you're inches away against an Old Dominion team that you know is going to score more.
Just keep in mind, they tried a couple quarterback sneaks, and that quarterback sneak did not even come close. It didn't look good when they tried it. They've also got their running back, their best running back, Jeremy Height, who's banged up and injured. The mentality is, hey, when you're on the road in a raucous environment, you're that close, throw out the rules. Play for the win.
Whitener, the running back. He's got 7 TDs on the year. Hillary out of a taut pistol and Jumbo. 5 seconds. Whitener. Short again. Whitener does not get in. Time is gone. Old Dominion holds.
I think they're going to have to review this one. And he left his feet.
The previous play is under further review.
You know, but that's one of the disadvantages when you go to the pistol shotgun. You're starting off behind the line of scrimmage. Let's take a look. He leaves his feet, and he didn't get in. Wow. That ball, from the angles we see, that ball never crossed the goal line. I mean, this is the best look you're going to see. Helmet. Nope. Whoa. Is that the ball? Is that the ball I saw right there that was on the white stripe?
Remember, you need indisputable video evidence to overturn the call of the field. That's about as close as you can come.
It is. And keep in mind, I mean, all you need to do is show that that ball touched that white line you saw on the field. See, there it's no, no, no. But you're going to see at the bottom of the pile right there, that ball might have touched. And if he had control of the football, then that'd have to be a touchdown.
Here's the word.
The ruling on the field is that the player fumbled the football. Old Dominion covered at the half-yard line. The half is over.
So they actually called it the fumble.
So they go 10 plays, 87 yards, 3.5 minutes, and get nothing. Our score at halftime, Old Dominion 28, Coastal Carolina 21. Come on back following the break. Matt Schick, Mike Bellotti, and Tom Luganville take a look at the top 5 plays from last week. Preview more games played later today, and Heisman candidate talk. All coming up on the Halftime Report. dancing in the end zone. There's been a lot of that today. Old Dominion with 28, Coastal Carolina 21. Second half about to get underway in this second round playoff matchup. And here are the numbers from the explosive first half. Reason to dance all about, as Old Dominion didn't really do it in the air quite as much as we would have thought. In fact, the yardage numbers favor Coastal, but they turn it over.
Yeah, I think the big surprise is you got the turnovers there, but who would have thought Coastal Carolina would have more yards, total yards at halftime than Old Dominion? You would think, well, Old Dominion must be getting beat, but no, that's not the case. You can't look at the scoreboard. Old Dominion's been effective. They kept the pressure on, but 6-9 on third down conversions for Coastal Carolina. That's been huge for them. That's what's kept them in this football game.
Even the crutch does not hold you back. If you feel it, you've got to do it. These teams can taste the national quarterfinals. The winner of this game faces the winner of Georgia Southern and Central Arkansas. And at last check, that's a blowout in favor of the seeded Eagles. Old Dominion, as the higher seed, would host should it prevail. But if it's Coastal Carolina, Georgia Southern, with that triple option offense holds on, it would be a visit to Statesboro. New Hampshire at last check, only one TD, trailing by a score against Wofford, another triple option team out of the SoCon. And Old Dominion, in its last year in the CAA, was ineligible to win the league, which it would have done since it's defecting for the FBS ranks and eventually Conference USA. Trying to carry the banner, something that Bobby Wilder said he's still proud to do as a longtime CAA coach.
Defecting is such a harsh term. Defecting to the C Conference USA. I think they like to say they're moving on up to the Conference USA. I mean, the success he's had here, but right now I'll tell you, you're only up by one score at home hosting the playoff game. He's got to concentrate on this Coastal Carolina team, but showing time and time again, they've got plenty of fight and they don't plan on going anywhere.
Old Dominion from its 14 gets to the 31. Here are the scores. Appalachian State, the mighty Mountaineers, trailing Illinois State, a team that, Jay, you thought maybe shouldn't have been in the field.
Yeah, I thought that was a questionable call for them to get in there, and they're trying to prove Jay Walker wrong. They're leading 14-10 right now over App State. And talked about Georgia Southern over Central Arkansas, and update on that Wofford, New Hampshire. It's now 13-7, so the other team that's still remaining in the postseason play from the CAA, trying to make that game closer.
Hand off on first down. Old Dominion came out at the start of the game running a bit. That's a gain of six for Tyree Lee.
Be interesting to see what are the halftime adjustments made, not just by Coastal, but by both defenses. Obviously, both teams, what they were doing really didn't work in the first half. I mean, offense was moving the ball up and down the field. For Coastal, we saw them start to play some man-to-man coverage, and it seems as if they're starting to do that again here in the second half.
Hand off, not much. In fact, make it no gain. Darius Hawthorne in on the hit along with Mike McClure. Well, remember, ODU in its regular season finale at James Madison was down a couple of scores at the break, played a great second, had a similar game, the contest before against William & Mary, and Bobby Wilder said he has a second half oriented defense. Here it's his offense on third down at a long cadence. Heinicke pressured. The little dump. And right near the marker.
Oh, they got the spot. Wow, we know that there are going to be some changes made by Coastal. They brought the corner blitz, and the problem was the corner blitz didn't get there in time. And Heinicke, once again, able to buy a little bit of time, elude the rush, just make a quick little dump off to get the first down.
How about that line in front of him? Heinicke, who's generously listed at 6'1". He's probably around 5'10", 5'11". That line goes 6'4", 6'8", 6'4", 6'6", 6'4". All in the high twos, low 300s. Deep ball. Man coverage nearly picked off. The leap by Ladarius Hawthorne.
Wow, they've been going at all game. Ladarius Hawthorne and Blair Roberts. Those have been some battles over on that side. Roberts did a good job of getting some separation on the go route. He's up by a step, but he pushes, and actually he doesn't recognize the ball was underthrown. Hawthorne missed opportunity for that interception there.
Well, second down. Heinicke has been picked 13 times this year, but never in postseason play. Blitz off the near edge. He goes opposite on the screen. First hits are not bringing down ball carriers. Gain of 8 for Tyree Lee.
And this is a quarterback that's in command of his offense. Sees the blitz, recognizes where his hot read is. Simple little swing pattern. Thrown to his left. The blitz doesn't get there in time. Hold on to the ball. Get the ball to my running back out of the backfield in space. And he was almost able to pick up the first down.
Chance to hydrate the lineman, as there's a banged up player for Coastal Carolina. Down to the field, Johnny Hartsfield, the Hofstra transfer, a first team all conference defensive tackle. He was hurt in the Bethune-Cookman game, played through the injury. He'll be helped off.
Now, this is quarterback in 101. This is what you want to see. The blitz is coming from here and here. Now, a normal young quarterback will panic and get rid of the football right away. Watch how long Heinicke holds on to it so you can buy some time. Hold on to it for that extra second where you allow more separation for the running back. That's quarterback in 101 right there. That's how you handle a blitz. You bait them, let them think they've got you, just go to your hot read.
A third down, quick hit, first down. Larry Pickard gets a block. Pickard galloping toward the end zone. And just short. Looks like they'll mark him at the 3. Took out an official in the process. Big play in a big way. 47 yards.
Pinker did a great job of running after this catch. He's going to make the leave, and I guess they're going to say he stepped out of bounds. Oh, he didn't step out.
Official's timeout.
He left his feet, got that ball, hit the pylon. That may be a touchdown.
You see the follow-through of Pernell Williams, the whip hybrid linebacker safety, takes out the official.
The player was out of bounds. The previous play is under further review.
So they're going to take another look. Started the drive with 2 runs, then 4 straight passes. Could this be a 50-yarder for a score?
I didn't see anything that said he stepped out of bounds. I mean, it's that left leg. He's airborne. He elevates. That ball touches the pylon. I think that should be a score. Thing you see right there, the official goes down, so he loses, you know, his spot where he is, and that's when you've got to rely upon the other official. Look at the athleticism. He was 4 yards out and extended, was able to touch that pylon. That tells you what type of athlete Larry Pinkard is. Sophomore from Washington, D.C. He's got 42 catches on the year. 4 TDs, looking for its 5th.
The redshirt sophomore became a regular starter midway through last year. And he's one of the many weapons for Taylor Heinicke in 2012. Remember, Coastal Carolina, last play of the first half, went for it on 4th down with a chance to tie the game. Now could be looking at a 2-score deficit. Even if this isn't a score, it's prime position.
Yeah, and at some point, I think, you know, you take points in the postseason. You've got to take points in the postseason. I know you get caught up in the moment. That's what we talk about the half, how Old Dominion just started to dictate the tempo and make this a shootout. And you've got teams turning down 3 points going into the half. And
well, if it's not a score, Jay, definitively they have to move the ball closer, right? He's clearly not out of the 3.
Yeah, he clearly wasn't at the 3-yard line. He left his feet at the 4, inbound.
Here's the call.
After further review, the ruling on the field is reversed. Touchdown.
Touchdown number 5 for Larry Pinkard. The 3rd of the day for Taylor Heinicke. 2-score advantage, Monarchs.
We talked about it earlier. I know it's tough for Coastal Carolina to hear this, but as long as they get the call right, and I think they got the call right. Great individual effort by Pinkard to score. Right now, Coastal Carolina finds themselves in some trouble here early in the second half.
Jared Brown trying to make it 64-64 on extra points. After a six-play, 69-yard drive, took 2 minutes and 24 seconds. Bobby Wilder beckons over our referee, Larry Saunders. Is there issue with the clock?
Yeah, I like it.
Jared Brown.
Indeed, they put another 3 seconds on the game clock to 12:39. So make it a 2 minute, 21 second drive. Brown's kick out of the hold of Nate Ong is good. Taylor Heinicke's pretty good as well. He's got a 2-touchdown lead. Heinicke finds his target. Nearly half the field traversed by Larry Pinkard. Old Dominion, 35-21. The riverfront in Norfolk, Virginia, one of the most heavily trafficked seaports in our great country. Many naval positions down here, and the man who traversed the sea of green. His name is Pinkard. Larry Pinkard of Washington, D.C., got his fifth TD of the year after video replay overruled him being out at the 350-yard score. 2-touchdown lead for the 4-seed Old Dominion. Here's Henderson from inside of his own 10 for the Chanticleers. Spilled at the 23. That's a return of 14 yards. John Sadak and former NFL quarterback Jay Walker with you at Foreman Field. It's another sellout for Old Dominion. 27 home games, 27 sellouts. As Aramis Hillary needs to add to those numbers, Jay, down a couple of scores.
And they've put plenty of stress on their offense in situations like this. Down by 14, you've got to score to stay in this football game. Defense has not been able to make the stops, but give credit to the Coastal Carolina offense. When they've had to come up with a score, they've managed to do it.
Flush to his right, throws on the run. Throws that one away. Should be noted, Marcus Whitener, the running back, not Jeremy Height, who was hurt on the second to last play of the first half. And now it's another banged up Chanticleer. And Coastal has had a number of injuries on the year, including half a dozen all conference performers, some of their biggest names.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you ask yourself, how are they still able to come in a tie in the Big South Conference here. Give them credit for that. Just losing that alone is a lot, but then there's more. The list goes on and on. Key players that have missed time with an injury this year, but through it all, they've battled, and that's why you have to assume that they will continue to battle and stay in this football game.
On that first page was the name David Duran, the Michigan State transfer, as Whitener gets a gain of about four. He was named an honorary captain today. He's not allowed to dress. NCAA rules limit how many can dress, so he has to sit in the stands. But they got special permission for him to go out for the coin toss before the game and still be a leader of this football team.
That's a good touch, and that's a good sign for Coastal Carolina right now. Jeremy Height making his first appearance here in the second half at the running back position.
Split backfield. They rush four after disguising a blitz. And still they get pressure on Hillary, who finds positive yardage, but on third down is still about 3.5 yards short of the marker.
This is going to be the defining point in this football game now. So they've got to punt the ball away. And we knew sooner or later the defense is going to have to make a stop. If Coastal punts and Old Dominion gets the ball back and scores, it puts them down by 21.
First punt of the game, Austin Kane, the sophomore out of Kennesaw, Georgia. Antonio Vaughn, the return man, and it's a fake. Direct snap and a first down in the process.
Whoa. They got it, but that's what Bobby Wilder wants. He wants teams to get desperate, and had they been caught short, it would have been a sure score. But I think Coach Moglio realized the game was on the line, and they actually sniffed it out. That was just a great effort to get across the first down marker to pick that up with the season on the line. Lorenzo Taliaferro. Whew, what a gutsy call.
Well, they like taking chances on special teams. Both teams do. First punt of the game never happens. Now a swing pass, not a great ball. Terrell Blanks gets lit up as a result.
Now look at the recognition by Reggie Owens on this. If you're going to play that cornerback position, unfortunately he's down. The recognition, the moment he sees it's this little bubble screen, he's on a pursuit angle to get the tackle for a loss.
Was that knee to knee? He got spun around when lower halves collided.
Looks as if he is grabbing his knee, his right knee.
He got his first career start in the 70-14 blowout of Campbell. As they tend to him, remind you, the 2012 NCAA Division I championship continues next weekend. Quarterfinals on December the 8th. All games will be on the ESPN family of networks. For more information, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 89 NCAA championships.
I think one of the big stories of the FCS postseason thus far has been one of CAA having Villanova, their regular season champ, with the automatic qualifier, getting beat in the first week. And then how about this conference, the Big South Conference, Coastal Carolina and Stony Brook both emerge victorious in week one, earning some respect and credibility for the Big South Conference.
And Stony Brook, of course, will be making its way to the CAA for football in the near future. This year beat Army rather handily, played very well in two games against FBS opponents, and took down Coastal. That was Coastal's last loss, 27-21, October 13th. All they've done is win since. On second down, Whitener showing blazing speed, undercut but somersaulted to the marker. Depends upon the spot.
It looked like he was going to be a big play, but great job by Felante Mischer, who's a safety, but because of the injury we just saw in the previous play to Reggie Owens, they moved him over to play cornerback. Hard tackle.
Let's see, does he have it? He is banged up and looks to be in pain. And pull the chains and see if it might add to it. Indeed, they're just short.
So So Mischer, who's normally a safety, they move him over to the cornerback position, and he sheds a block and helmet right on the knee. And you've got Whitener, who was running at full speed.
Marcus Whitener was one of those names you saw on the earlier graphic that missed half of the season. Since he had come back, he had been a nice change of pace back, averaging nearly 8 yards a carry, 7 TDs, and only 6 games played. Chanticleer, 6 of 10 on third down today. They need a couple of inches. Blitz comes. The handoff push is good for the first.
That was Lorenzo Talafaro. They're just struggling right now with the running backs are getting beat up. You've got Height out the game. Whitener's out the game now. That was just an effort there by Talafaro to just keep his legs churning. Thank goodness they only needed a couple of inches, because if they would have needed a full foot, he wouldn't have got it.
Well, first down, that's the 17th of the game for Coastal Carolina, squad that averages 5 yards a carry as a team entering today. But outside pressure gets to Hillary and brings him down to the backfield. Alex Orain. That's a loss of 5. He came to ODU as a wide receiver. He's now a defensive end.
And he's tall, coming around the edge, just beats his man. And you know, that's that matchup. They're in trouble right now. Coastal's beat up. Drew Herring, the right tackle, number 78. We saw him get banged up in the first half. In that case there, you actually saw Alex Orain just take advantage of his limited mobility and just go right around him. You got to watch and see. He's going to be able to block him right now. If they're trying to pass the ball, they better get some help and put a running back over there to maybe slow down the rush from that side.
That's exactly what Hillary does, as he moves a backer that way and is passing complete, looking for Bennett. He had Travis Small motion out to his right slightly.
Yep. And that's tough, though, because when that happens, and all you can do is a quick pass. And so now they're making an adjustment. They're going to the backup. So we just saw Drew Herring run off the field. They're going to bring in his backup. Now, so things weren't bad once. Now they're even worse. You got a backup right tackle there. And I think ODU senses that in the defensive line for Old Dominion is starting to really put pressure and have an impact on this football game.
Third and 15. Finds that safety valve and a first down. Matt Hazel. 2 TDs on the day, and they're an 18th first down for the Chanticleers.
I mean, how many times have we seen that? That was the theme of the first half. Their ability on third down to convert with big plays there. Getting the ball to Matt Hazel, their go-to wide receiver. He catches the ball short of the first down, but makes somebody miss and able to pick up the first down with the second effort.
23-yard completion taken down by Paul Morant. And DePaul, the 6th high school. Now pass over the middle, incomplete. Looked like some heavy contact right on the shoulder of Mastro Mateo.
I'm surprised they didn't call defensive holding there. Mastro Mateo basically was walled off from the inside.
You speak of the tackles. The left tackle, Chad Hamilton, was questionable. His 15-game start streak came to an end when he dressed but didn't play last week. Drew Herring was questionable today, left that Bethune game last week with injury. It's a patchwork bunch, and yet it had been hanging with ODU. Perhaps the attrition picking up as Small is spilled by Arane.
No ability to run the football. The teeth of the Old Dominion defense on the front line is Chris Burnett and Gunn Bailey from the defensive tackle position. Now when you've got tackles for Coastal Carolina that are banged up, hobbling around. Now the exterior, the outside rush, guys like Alex Arain and Preston Smith, now they're starting to make their impact in this game.
13th play of this drive. Coastal 8 of 9 on third down today. Empty set on third and 15. Completion, but nowhere near the first. Catch made by Terrell Blanks. That's a gain of 7.
You go for it here. Down by 14, offense, which is on fire. Your quarterback did your job of getting you some yardage on that play there, making it fourth and about 8 yards to go. I think you go for it. Your season's on the line. You realize if you don't get some points on the board right now, You could be watching your season dwindle away, control it in your own hands.
Shalta clears 2 for 3 on fourth down conversions today on the season, 4 of 13 entering the day. And a timeout called by Coastal Carolina.
Coastal Carolina, their first charge timeout of the half. 30 seconds timeout.
So the Chanticleers talk it over, and the finalists for the Eddie Robinson FCS Coach of the Year Award, Joe Moglia, chats with his staff. You know, he will be seeing Taylor Heinicke again. December the 17th is the awards presentation in Philadelphia, when we'll find out who's the Walter Payton winner. Heinicke is a finalist for that, as the Heisman of FCS. And who was the Coach of the Year? Moglia, a finalist for that honor.
Well, an interesting day there, giving away the Coach of the Year. You know all four awards. So you've got the Payton Award, which goes to the Heisman Trophy version of this one. Then you've also got Eddie Robinson Award Coach of the Year. You've got the Buck Buchanan, which goes to the Defensive Player of the Year. And then they also have a new award that's fairly new, which is the Jerry Rice Award, which goes to the Outstanding Freshman Impact Player of the Year.
Here are some of the notable FCS quarterbacks. Steve McNair, the record holder at Alcorn State. Joe Flacco, he was a transfer from Pitt.
I give you a name you're missing on that list.
Jay Walker.
Tony Romo. Romo, Eastern Illinois.
Some big-time names that Heinicke is closing in on. The all-time annals. Fourth down. Hillary. First down. Hazel again. Spun at the 12. Stays on his feet until a third lick is laid. Mark him officially at the 11. Gain of 21. They convert on fourth down.
And Matt Hazel's been their guy. That's the scouting report. He came in with 52 catches, leading his team, and got a little protection up front. Right when the pocket was getting ready to break down, you see Hazel. This is just will and determination. That's postseason football. He's got the yards, but he wants more. Continues to go. And even though he doesn't pick up much yardage after that, it's the effort and the will that you see that you have to like.
Illness cost him time as a freshman. Injury the same as a sophomore. He's the leader as a junior. Fade, end zone, touchdown. DeMario Bennett, that's his seventh of the year, team high.
I mean, these Chanticleers won't go away. The Old Dominion fans are ready to start their party and advance to the third round. Not so fast is what Coastal keeps saying. Fourth down, they convert, get the ball down here, and just a nicely thrown back shoulder fade to DeMario Bennett. Great adjustment on the ball. That's an indefensible play right there.
Corso, Coastal, is there something there? Not so fast?
That's what they're saying right now. ODU want to celebrate. Not so fast. Still a one touchdown score game.
The extra point, not to be overlooked, is good from Alex Catron. 15 plays, 76 yards, 6 minutes and 10 seconds. The Chanticleers resilient. They will not go down. They go end zone. One score game. 35-28. Old Dominion's lead slim to one score yet again. Just beyond the midway point of the third quarter, John Sadak and former NFL QB Jay Walker from Foreman Field, Coastal Carolina, chewed up some clock. Fade to DeMario Bennett. The score to get the shot that clears within one. And the wave. Playoff euphoria sweeping through here in Norfolk. Old Dominion's motto this year, one team, one year, one shot. Final year in the FCS ranks, final chance to win that national championship. Goodwin from his own three. Hard hit down to the 26, and with their season on the line, how about the effort of these Chanticleers?
I mean, fourth down, what a great effort here. You're going to see the quarterback just refusing to go down. They've got to get the first down to keep it going. They don't want to give the football back. And then on another big fourth and eight, they throw a strike to Matt Hazel. Hazel's able to get the first down, which led to the scoring pass that came to DeMario Bennett on this back shoulder fade. Great catch, great throw. Chanticleers only down by a score.
Turnover could really change the game around. Old Dominion running on first down to the 31, gain of about five. Tyree Lee.
And if you're Coastal, you've got to be thinking, we just have to keep hanging in there. I mean, Old Dominion is yet to turn the football over. Now maybe your defense can help jumpstart and make a quick play, turnover, get the ball back to the offense. They just keep hanging around.
Old Dominion had a fumble that it recovered. Taylor Heinicke has not been picked in postseason yet. The sophomore, designed middle screen, first down. Finds his back nearly to midfield, marked out at the 48-yard line. Let's survey the scores after that 17-yard run. Central Arkansas, Clint Conkin Company, making it a game in Statesboro, 24-16. That winner faces the winner of this affair. And Appalachian State down 11 to Illinois State.
Yeah, they're clearly on the ropes right there. And that's why you have to play it out on the field. You know, I think Illinois State shouldn't get in, but it's like, hey, they're proving they belong it in the postseason.
Oh, fumble! Coastal Carolina ball! There's the turnover. Recovered in the air by Dontavis Johnson.
And I hate to say I put the jinx on Old Dominion, but you just figured they've been playing so flawlessly and perfect. Rarely do you see a game where you don't turn the ball over once. And Coastal Carolina being opportunistic, trying to run the football. Tyree just gets a good pop late on him. He doesn't even see the hit coming.
His second fumble of the day, but the first lost. Chanticleers could tie it up. They're in ODU territory.
NCAA for the private use of our audience. Any other use of this telecast or any picture, descriptions, or accounts of the game without the NCAA's consent is prohibited.
Fumble by the young man, Tyree Lee. The sophomore from Hampton is second of the game, but the first lost. And that means Coastal Carolina has the ball in ODU territory at the 45. Handoff on first down. Travis Small, who is the third running back, due to other injuries, getting some carries, gets 4 yards.
This is just all guts right now and heart by the Coastal team. They've got a backup right tackle in there. Left tackle's banged up. Left guard's been banged up. Two running backs out of the contest. Down by a score with great field position.
Long cadence on second down. Blitz comes. Small helps to pick it up. Sling left side. Another catch for Hazel. Get him to the 22-yard line. That's a gain of 19. He is having a career day. 155 yards receiving.
And at what point do you double team him? I mean, they continue to put Reggie Owens on an island versus Matt Hazel, you know, one of the best offensive weapon they have right now for Coastal Carolina. We know that they like to play vanilla coverage at Old Dominion, but at some point, you've got to respect them and double team.
Shanta clears down some backers. Jeremy Height, Marcus Whitener have been banged up. Keeper by Hillary. Double teamed on the sandwich at around the 12. That'll be just short of the marker. Gain of 9.
When you're going to run that zone read, it's all about quarterbacks making great decisions. Good job by Hillary putting the ball in the belly of Small, pulling it, making a quick, decisive decision, able to pick up 9 yards.
None of this would be possible without the play of Johnny Houston, the strong safety. He was a national player of the week after forcing 2 fumbles, returning a pick for a TD last week against Bethune-Cookman. He jarred the ball loose to create this possession. Blitz comes. Man coverage. Hillary smothered.
You can't do that. Hillary's played a good game. When they blitz is coming and they surprise you with the blitz, you've got to get rid of the football. Then it would have been third and just a yard. Instead, he takes a sack. Once you see it right now, get rid of it. You're not going to run from it. Get rid of that football. Throw it out the back of the end zone. Instead, he takes a sack, which could be costly.
John Darr credited with a sack.
That's the matchup there. That's Matt Hazel. They need to double team him.
Hand off to Small. Touchdown. How does he have that much room? Right up the gut.
Just a nice crease. This is a banged up offensive line, but Old Dominion, when they struggle against the run, it's schematically, you're going to see the crease is going to come right here. Look, you should see right now, there's no second level linebacker there. So all you have to do is get to that part of the field. They try to do a run stunt blitz, doesn't work. Small finds a crease and makes him pay.
The second best rusher in South Carolina high school history just got his first rushing TD of this season. And with an extra point from Alex Catron, they tie the game. 5 plays, 45 yards, 2 minutes and 16 seconds. What a job by Coastal, which was down 2 scores and has deadlocked this game at Old Dominion. Silence in the stadium.
This is what postseason football is all about. You come on the road, you stay in the game. Just when you think your season's coming to a halt, down by 14, less than 5 minutes ago, they score, then they get the turnover. Tie up this football game. Great individual effort. Oh, I love it. Miss it. One of the best times I had in my whole life was my Howard University team went up to Marshall, and although we didn't emerge victorious, I never forgot that feeling. It's such a rush, and these young men are leaving it all out on the line on the field of play.
This is the 13th game of the year for the Chanticleers, who had to play last week. And they said they wanted that. They didn't want the bye that Old Dominion enjoyed because they were a hot team. And while they were banged up, they wanted to keep that rhythm going.
You know, winning's contagious, and they've been winning. And what a great job first-year coach Joe Moglio has done. I mean, phenomenal job.
Well, this team's got some fight. He's got an interesting perspective on coaching. You know, he said at certain points, I do run my program like a business, but I treat them like men first, and each person on this team has their own distinct personality. It's our job as coaches to learn what drives them in different ways. Some of them you have to scream at, others you have to nurture a little bit more, but he seems to have the winning formula.
Goodwin on the kick return. Bobs and weaves to around the 35. That's a return of 15 yards. Well, Joe Moglia has led in the boardroom. He now leads on the football field once more. And we asked him, what's harder? What's the more challenging aspect? And he essentially said both.
And his reason was?
He said that on any one day, the game day, the game week is the most stressful, the most intense. But in the business world, you must perform quarter to quarter, and constantly the bar is raised. So business world on a full year sense, but football, you have the offseason to wind down a bit. No wind down as the wind up from Heinicke, and the swing pass gets to the 29. Game three.
And right now, you're starting to see a little momentum shift. The hits from Coastal Carolina are coming a little bit harder. I mean, take a listen to this hit here at the end of the run. The whole crowd said, ooh, now they're starting to realize they're in this game, playing with a new sense of urgency.
That was Johnny Hartsfield, who was helped off the field earlier and was banged up last week against Bethune-Cookman. Plenty of time for Heinicke. Wide open target. Antonio Vaughn beyond midfield. Mark him at the Coastal 48.
You know, the man's going to get some first down, but they can't get the quarterback pressure. When you give a quarterback like Taylor Heinicke that much time, he will pick you apart. But the key for Coastal Carolina, keep everything in front of you. Do not give up the big play.
That last one went for 23. First down. Blitz. The pump. They duped the defenders. Flag comes out as Vaughn stumbles on the sideline. It gets shoved out of bounds by Dontavis Johnson.
Keep everything in front of him. Don't give up the big play. This will be a penalty, I'm sure, that Old Dominion's going to turn down. But they got him on the double move with the pump go, the sluggo.
Here's the call.
Holding on the defense. That penalty is declined. First down.
So they'll keep the 39-yard completion.
Keep everything in front of you. He bites. Looking in the backfield, that's what you, as a quarterback, you want the defensive back looking at you and not paying attention to the wide receiver. Good route by Antonio Vaughn, but a great job by Taylor Heinicke of duping the defensive back with the pump.
Last two Old Dominion plays have gone for 24 and 39. They now need just 9 for a score. And the handoff only gets a couple.
The way this game's been played thus far, this is 4-down territory for the Monarchs. Coach Wilder is not afraid to roll the dice. You've got to think in this type of game that he's created here, if they have a 4th-down opportunity, they won't settle for a field goal try.
And notice that was Goodwin on that carry. We haven't seen much of Lee since that game-changing fumble. Heinicke locked right side. Throws there. End zone. Incomplete. Again, it was Vaughn.
Heinicke with the read. Vaughn had his hands on it, but just not able to secure the football before the hit.
It looked like Quinn Backus, Big South Defensive Player of the Year, helped jar that free.
I'd find Nick Mayer. This is Mayer right here for Old Dominion. You've got to know where he is. I would not single cover him.
Heinicke, deep left corner, touchdown! Larry Pinker, his 2nd score of the day and 6th of the year.
If you've got a wide receiver matched up versus a linebacker, or a safety, advantage wide receiver, advantage offense. Pinker ran the corner route. Look at this air Heinicke puts underneath this ball. Allowing Pinkar just to run underneath it, get 2 feet in bounds for the score.
Extra point. Good. So after Coastal slogged out a lengthy drive, ODU, matter-of-factly, 6 plays, 74 yards, 159.
And you got this much air right here, you're going to see a great job of coming up and running to the back corner of the end zone. How do you defend that there? A guy like Heineke is going to put plenty of air underneath that football, plenty of separation. Easy throw, easy catch, touchdown, Old Dominion.
And that's another injury-riddled matchup. Tyler McCarthy, the junior out of Attleboro, Massachusetts, was a rotation man. And then Richie Sampson got hurt. He took over at free safety. They lost a little bit at that position.
Yep, you do anytime you're moving people around in your secondary. That's what a good offense is going to do. Give credit to the offensive coordinator, Brian Scott, here at Old Dominion. You want to put your playmakers on the field in the best position possible to take advantage of a mismatch. If you can get a wide receiver lined up one-on-one versus a safety, that's the matchup that you want. You increase your opportunity for success.
And Brian Scott was a quarterback for Bobby Wilder at Maine. Wilder, class of 87 at Maine. Scott, class of 2000. But those Black Bear teams couldn't recruit the same caliber of athlete as Old Dominion, so the offense does not look anything like what that duo ran in the Great White North.
Yeah, the Maine offense for years, power. They were strong teams. They would beat you in the trenches and run hard in between the tackles. Now they come down here and get a little bit of the salt water in the air, in the tidewater area. They've got speed, but they're utilizing it, putting five receivers on the field often.
Here's the kick, not well angled, out of bounds. Heineke, though, his second half, 8 of 10, 153 yards, 2 TDs for the man who was overlooked by many out of suburban Atlanta. His offense was centered around two very good running backs until his senior year, and many did not notice.
Kick out of bounds on the kicking team, number 39. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line, first down.
He threw for over 4,000 yards as a high school senior.
And still gets overlooked. And sometimes the things that are just, you know, throw the measurables out, you know, height, weight, 40-yard dash time. The quarterback position, you want to have a winner, somebody that knows how to win. And then more important, I think if you're an accurate passer and you can pick apart a defense, you can play college football.
Aramis Hillary has shown that he certainly has that swagger about him today. First down, throws a little short. Terrell Blanks, a freshman out of Fort Myers, Florida.
This is probably the third play I've seen where they've not had Matt Hazel on the field. Third consecutive play, I should say. After he made a catch, we haven't seen much of him. That's you just wonder, is that injury bug still continuing to bite the Chanticleers?
He's got a career best 155 yards receiving. And he has set a school record for receptions in a year. So flag comes out at the snap. Goes on Mo Ashley, given name Matthew, who has started every game this year at right guard, a sophomore. And for two teams that draw a ton of penalties normally for run of play action, we haven't seen a lot. Most of it has been on specials.
It's been a pretty clean game and a very exciting and entertaining game.
Last minute of the third quarter. Big pressure, and Hillary throws behind his dump off man to Travis Small. Hazel was back out there for that play. Coastal has already exceeded its per game scoring average, but Jay, they can put points up. They hung 65 at Presbyterian on November 10th.
Yeah. They average 42 points a game, so you know they have the ability to score.
Third and 15. They've gotten the big play in this spot all day. Hillary hit as he throws, and that wobbler incomplete, nearly picked off.
That defensive line for Old Dominion is really starting to take advantage of a banged up offensive unit, particularly on the offensive line for Coastal Carolina. And you can tell Hillary's getting frustrated. He's been dropping back, getting hit pretty often here in the second half every time he drops back to throw a pass.
Remember, Coastal has not punted today. The only other punt look, it ran a fake successfully. This time the ball does go to Austin Kane, who punts it back to the retreating fair catch signal put up and made by Antonio Vaughn. So a 45-yard punt. Old Dominion the ball up 7. Let's check some of the other scores around the FCS ranks. Wofford leading comfortably against New Hampshire. Still a one-score game. Each side has put up more at Appalachian State. Georgia Southern still only a one-score lead with a conversion against Central Arkansas.
Up by 8, but that Illinois State game getting interesting. 7-point game there, so Mountaineers have managed to shrink the lead down to 7. Once upon a time, they were down by 11 not too long ago.
And off on first down to the 30, a gain of 5. Mike McClure the tackle. That last possession for Coastal Carolina, Jay, 3 and out, it took 22 seconds.
Incomplete passes will do that. They brought the pressure, and look at this. I mean, talk about the effort. They continue to stay in this football game in spite of. We've seen many more white jerseys down on the field with injury this football game compared to the blue and black of Old Dominion. But the kids from South Carolina just keep hanging in there. Now that's Mike McClure, their starting strong side linebacker.
Well, remember, they were 2-4. They beat North Carolina A&T, got a huge win in triple overtime at Furman, and then lost to 4 straight ranked teams, Eastern Kentucky, at FBS Toledo, at App State, to Stony Brook, longtime league power by a score, and have only won since. Kansas State's fantastic regular season comes to a close. A must-win finale in Manhattan. So Wildcats look to secure a Big 12 title, an automatic BCS bid against Case McCoy and the Longhorns. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows 8. Number 18, Texas. Number 6, Kansas State. Tonight at 8 on ABC, part of Championship Week. 2nd and 5 as the squad slog it out for a championship in the FCS ranks. Swing pass read well. Nothing there. Colton Blackburn, the backup middle linebacker.
That was Blackburn. He was shot on a missile. Made a buzz route towards a wide receiver. Good hit. Now Coastal putting a little pressure on. Can they get a stop?
Lost 3. It's 3rd and 8. It's the end of the third quarter. We'll step aside. The 4th and final frame. But we come back 42-35.
NCAA.com is your online destination for college sports. With comprehensive video highlights and editorial coverage of FCS, Division II and Division III football playoffs, along with soccer, volleyball, cross-country, and field hockey championships across all 3 divisions, NCAA.com has extensive coverage of your favorite schools and your favorite sports this fall. NCAA.com, the home of college sports.
fourth quarter about to get underway. Second round of the FCS Championship between Old Dominion and Coastal Carolina. Welcome on back, John Sadak and the Skywalker himself, former NFL QB Jay Walker. Jay, this day has been defined by the resiliency of Coastal Carolina.
The ability to hang in this game in spite of the different injuries that they've had to overcome, and now a key third down. Can they get a stop when needed?
Old Dominion, big play over the top. Touchdown! Larry Pinkert, 73 yards, his third score of the day. He had four all year entering this afternoon.
And Pinkert's been the one where they've gotten the matchup versus somebody from the opposing secondary, meaning a safety or a linebacker, and he wins that matchup every time. Exploiting the middle of the field, becomes a foot race to the end zone between Quinn Backus, who's a great linebacker for Coastal Carolina, and Larry Pinkert. You got to think Pinkert is going to win that matchup. They put Backus in a tough situation, and the Monarchs made him pay.
Three plays, 75 yards, 49 seconds. Taylor Heinicke, he has been earning his keep.
And that's a throw you want. Wide receiver running down the middle of the field versus a linebacker. If he can get behind him, it makes it an easy throw and an easy catch.
This Old Dominion team has so many weapons, has so much offense, and yet Coastal Carolina keeps answering the bell. The problem here, though, Jay, they're running out of time. It's the fourth quarter.
Start of the fourth quarter. The key is this is the pressure that they've put on their offense all game long. They get down by 14, where the offense must score. This game will be over, but they've responded time and time again. Can the offense do it one more time to keep this defense and this Coastal Carolina team in this football game and the season alive? But give credit to Aramis Hillary. I've been impressed. Every time they've been in this position before, they've managed to claw their way back. You just wonder, are they relying on the offense one time too many?
Are we sure that Ashaun DeClear is not a white rabbit that lives in a hat? That's what it feels like.
Yeah, or a cat that's got nine lives, because they seem to have that. But I'm just so impressed with what they've done. And I mean, who are we to think it won't happen again? They've been able to do it time and time again. Season on the line, fourth down with nine to go, and they come up with a big play, and then they go for a fake punt, which leads to another score.
How about Taylor Heinicke? Second half alone, he's 10 of 12, three TDs, 223 yards, and it's just the start of the fourth quarter. Henderson from the shadows of his goalposts. Henderson to the 35. Henderson midfield.
Woo! He's got some jets. Did you see the angle in which he outran the kickoff cover team? He starts on the right, comes all the way left, and there's several people that have the angle on him, but this is speed right here. He's outrunning their angles, stays in bounds. Wow, he can fly.
He averages nearly 30 yards of return, 55 on that one. And every time the Chanticleers have needed the big play, they've gotten it. The fumble forced and recovered. Now the big kick return. Hand off. Whitener back in the game, gets three.
And they're doing that with a patch mail offensive line. Right now, just no continuity there. Banged up left tackle, right tackle, guard, but they continue to fight, find a way. Credit this offensive line, the backups, for stepping up and doing a good job.
Motion from Mastro Mateo. The split backfield, Whitener greeted on high, thrust back down to earth at the 39.
Talk about Whitener, who's the backup running back, is Jeremy Heiden. He's a little banged up, so they've had to do running back by committee. This is just a gutsy effort by Coastal Carolina.
Third and six.
I've got one-on-one with Matt Hazel at the top of your screen.
ODU rushes four. Hillary pressured, slips, and falls down. Loses a yard in the process.
I don't know why Hillary didn't go to Matt Hazel. They had the matchup that you wanted. 10-yard out route. Hazel beat his man. Hillary looked him off and
took a sack.
Fourth down, offense on the field. They come to their feet at Foreman Field. Hillary sacked. There's that man again, Alex Arane. Levels him on his own side of the 50. Loss of 13.
And the few times they decided to double team Matt Hazel, Hillary didn't recognize it. He kept looking over at Hazel, but there was a safety over the top. So he's looking to his left. That's where Hazel is. He's the only wide receiver on that side of the field. You see the coverage is there. Nowhere to go with the football. And in case of Coastal Carolina, that's a tough one. Start to think maybe too much pressure on the offense. One time too many. Now it's a team game. I think you've got to leave your comfort zone defensively. You got to play with dynamite, but you've got to blitz Taylor Heinicke. You've got to try and get the ball out of his hands, create a turnover. You're down by 14 on the road with 12 minutes to go in the game.
After the turnover on downs, let's see indeed what Heinicke can do. Protecting the football paramount. They rush four. Open is his regular target. So he goes to the top receiver, Nick Mayers. First down, gain of 11.
See, they've shown every time you want to play zone coverage and not bring any pressure on the pocket, Heinicke picks you apart with his pre-snap read, just getting the ball to his playmakers. This is the most vanilla look that they've seen.
How about that? Old Dominion, 9 yards per play, dwarfing Coastal's efficiency. Another dump, this time missed tackle by Backus. And a big chunky yardage for the Monarchs. To the 8 of 7.
It's too easy right now. Heinicke knows when there's any sense of pressure, then he's making a check. Right now, they haven't given him the threat of pressure. He's able to go through all three of his reads, make easy throws in space. No threat of a blitz right now. He knows it, so he's going to go through his full progression.
Pump, open target right side. Caught at the 30, first down. An escort takes Vaughn out of bounds. This facility is gorgeous. It was open from 1936 until 1941 for the William & Mary Norfolk Division football team. And then a fine came down and some other issues off the field. The program was shut down, and it's only in its fourth year back trying to get to a national quarterfinal. Hand off on first down. And add another first out of the total for the Monarchs. They're inside of the 15.
I'm sure that Brian Scott, the offensive coordinator for ODU, this is what he wants to see. This is what you call a game-clinching drive right now. Eating up some clock, taking what the defense has given him, running the football when needed.
And Goodwin with that run. Bobby Wilder has known nothing but tremendous success early. Heinicke trying to pad the advantage. Dropped at the end zone. That was a score for Blair Roberts, who already has a couple of TDs on the day.
On the end route, and this ball's thrown. You got to make that catch. That would have been a touchdown for him.
Well, one reason that Wilder has had such success is he cherry-picked ideas from Coastal Carolina. Play fake. A screen to Mayer. Eludes the first hit, second level, touchdown! Joe Moglia in disbelief.
Great job by Marquell Thomas on the blocker. You're going to see it on the left side. Watch him seal the edge. Stay on your block. Good job by Mayers to set up Thomas on the block. And Mayers is a guy that Gets plenty of yards after catch. It's not an unusual sight here in Norfolk.
Extra point good. Old Dominion pulling away. Heinicke to Mears, a familiar formula. 56-35. Old Dominion. The Monarchs enjoying a huge advantage. Taylor Heinicke, 6 touchdowns, no picks. He's completed 70% of his passes for over 400 yards. You can see it in the eyes of these Chanticleers. The pull away beginning. But they're even in Boone, North Carolina. Appalachian State has tied things up with Illinois State.
Wow, that's a close football game. Getting tight. That's what postseason football is all about. Georgia Southern holding on, less than 4 minutes to go there versus Central Arkansas with an 8-point edge.
Anderson elects to take it out of his own end zone. Anderson making a few man miss. Ultimately wrapped up, forward progress stopped at the 23. Jay, did you hear something interesting as a flag is out, by the way, all the way back where the kick came from, just as we were coming back from break?
During the break, there's a big stadium announcement saying tickets for the Old Dominion game versus either Georgia Southern or
Central Arkansas.
Or Central Arkansas will be available tomorrow at 10 a.m. Do you think that they're thinking this game is over?
That is confidence. And this penalty is on the Monarchs.
Offsides on the kicking team, number 40. That's a 5-yard penalty. We'll re-kick.
And I like the decision to make them re-kick because, I mean, one thing that they've shown for Coastal Carolina is that Trey Henderson can motor in terms of kickoff return. Give him an opportunity. Try and break one quickly. He's exciting to watch. They've got a pretty good kickoff return team out there.
This Old Dominion unit that has so many weapons, can do so much. Perhaps peeking an eye forward at who it might be at last check, Georgia Southern by 8 over Central Arkansas. That would make for an interesting storyline. The two programs that are comparable as startups, Georgia Southern, the gold standard at the level, which has won an FCS best 6 championships. And of course, they met in the playoffs last year. Old Dominion's first playoff loss came at the hands of the Eagles from Georgia Southern.
Georgia Southern had 600 yards of total offense, and Old Dominion kind of gave them a dose of their own medicine, but on the ground. Old Dominion likes to throw the ball. Georgia Southern is going to keep it on the ground.
And this one a much deeper kick, but it goes out of bounds. We've seen that many times today, and so making the Marie kick pays off.
Gained a couple of yards. I still would have liked to have seen the ball in the hands of Trey Henderson, the way he returns kicks. He's been exciting. One of those get on the edge of your seat type return men.
Well, let me ask you this. Is there any chance you do that intentionally? Because he hasn't shown a leg that he can kick for a touchback. Yep. You nullify Henderson's ability to get better yards. They have very similar field position to what they just had.
Yep.
Free kick out of bounds on the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 40-yard line. First down.
Well, Coastal Carolina with good position, but it's 56-35, fourth quarter. And a handoff on first down. Back in the game is Jeremy Height. I think this is the first time we've seen him on the half. Gain of 11, first down.
Yeah, particularly with the carry, running the football. Right now, you have to have a sense of urgency right now. Get up to the line of scrimmage. I like this by Coastal Carolina. Pick up the tempo. Try and score fast.
Hand off again to Height. This time, read very well. Multiple black jerseys bring him down for a loss of a yard. This is the first all-time meeting between these programs. Coastal Carolina 2-4 against CAA teams, beat then number one and defending national champ JMU in 05. But there is a somewhat of a common opponent. Coastal's lone conference loss was Stony Brook, a playoff team. ODU's only loss was Villanova. This one tipped and knocked away. And of course, Villanova met Stony Brook in the first round of these playoffs.
And Villanova got beat by Stony Brook. Andy Talley's team a little bit disappointing there for the Wildcats. Look at that effort there for Hayes to almost come down with that football. When you've got a wide receiver with that type of size and that type of athleticism and know-how, as a quarterback, there's a comfort level you have. You say, hey, even if I make a bad read on a play like that, I know he will not allow the other team to intercept the pass.
Third and 11. That's somewhat moot. It's definitive four down time. They just rushed four. Hillary is all day. And pocket starts to collapse on the edge. Throw short. Looking for DeMario Bennett.
And right now, Hillary's not getting a good pre-snap read or the most out of his read and recognition. Holding on to the football, looking at the rush a little bit and getting flushed out of the pocket.
Why punt here, Jay?
Because the quarterback hadn't looked good. I mean, he tried to throw the ball. He didn't even come close. Maybe special teams can make a play for you, but I agree. I think season's on the line. You go for it from here on, but we're in the booth.
Austin Kane. Fair catch by Vaughn. ODU is inside of its own 15. And with that, we'll step aside. We'll be back with more fourth quarter action in this second round playoff tilt. ODU 56, Coastal Carolina 35. 56-35 Old Dominion. Taylor Heinicke has been a man among boys today.
Had the ability to really hurt this team with his legs in the first half, prolonging the plays, making things happen.
As he passes on first down and gets a first down. That's a gain of 13 as he finds Larry Pinkard. Heinicke, six passing touchdowns, Jay. Two on the ground. He's one off his career high for passing TDs. He had seven against Campbell. The six has tied an FCS playoff record.
And then do we also mention that he rushed for two touchdowns as well?
So yeah.
We're just seeing what he's done with his arm. But first half, it was his legs that really opened up the passing lanes.
He'll throw again. We'll get a couple. They chew some clock and find number two, Kirk Spellman. Can Old Dominion win the national championship with a defense that's obviously susceptible? That's something Bobby Wilder talked about. He said he thought the most consistent defense will win the title.
Yeah, I mean, it takes defense to win championships. That's not just a cliche that's made up. You know, you can't go out there and just outgun everybody week in and week out. I think, you know, if the defense, they've got some talent. There's talent on the defense. I think the secondary of the defense is the real soft spot, and that's a problem. You know, if you have a linebacker that's not that good, or a defensive lineman, you can hide him. Pretty tough to hide folks in the secondary when they want to take advantage of it. But I do believe that, you know, I said it on the selection show, I think Old Dominion got a pretty nice draw. It's a pretty favorable draw if you look at, if they have to take on a team next week who they'll end up playing, which will be probably, looks like, Georgia Southern, who's a run first team.
After a 16-yard completion, try another big chunk, knifing into Coastal territory in the 27-yard line. And it's Colby Goodwin. Well, Old Dominion is a little bit against the grain. 10 of the 16 remaining FCS teams at the start of the day, top 25 in the country running the ball. 8 of the top 13, 5 of the top 6. But while Old Dominion can run, it is by far the most pass heavy of the remaining squads.
It is, but they've got the most dangerous offense, I think, out there. A quarterback that can throw and run is probably going to lose the finalists for the Peyton Award. I mean, they're dangerous, there's no doubt. This all comes down to the defense. If they can defend, and keep in mind in the postseason, when you've got an offense as good and quick strike ability as Old Dominion, you really only need your defense to make 3 or 4 stops a game. If they can come up with those 3 or 4 stops, 3 and outs, and they can continue to move the ball as efficiently as they have shown the ability to do, very nice chance. And, you know, I was going back to the draw they got. So if they win this game, they would end up hosting. Keep in mind they're hosting either Georgia Southern or Central Arkansas. I think they match up better with Georgia Southern, believe it or not, rather than Central Arkansas, because of the balance that Central Arkansas has been throwing and running. And then if they can get a quick lead on them, then they'll probably end up taking on, you know, North Dakota State up there, which would be a one where anytime you can jump out and score, you got a chance.
And how about the wide receiving corps? So much talent, and it takes a lot of selflessness to be willing to give up touches for your teammates, since the difference between each man is not that significant.
It's not. I mean, the best playmaker of the bunch is Mayers. And Mayer, I mean, he had no problem today playing a secondary role, allowing Pinkard, Markwell Thomas, and the others to make some plays. But when it was that game-clinching touchdown, I think it was the one that Nick Mayers had. But talented bunch. They all run very well. They block for each other. You can tell that they know that they're the strength of this team, and they continue to show it.
Gain of a dozen for Thomas. There's Mayers, first team all CAA. Now over 1,000 yards receiving. On first down, Thomas again. One-on-one in space. Good job by Dontavis Johnson to bring him down right around the 5. This facility was renovated for $25 million when it reopened in 2009. And this was the vision. Get this football to championship level. Get it to top 10 national championship contender in the FCS ranks. It was not expected. Conference USA comes calling.
And they're in the process now of doing a study to figure out how much more expansion they should do to their stadium. How many more seats do they need to put in? I like the way that they're taking their model. Don't build it too big where you have to try and fill it. They're saying fill it first, then expand it. And I think that's the model that works in most businesses across the country.
Well, they have a waiting list that if you fulfilled every ticket for each member on the list, they would sell 35,000 seats tomorrow to every game. On the ground for the second time of the drive, touchdown, Old Dominion.
Well, you asked me if they could win a championship. I would pose this question to you. Who do you think wants to play? With an offense like this, this is a scary draw. If you have to take on Old Dominion head to head.
Goodwin gallops in. Played at the same high school as Tyree Lee. Had some fumbled issues earlier. Goodwin's gotten the bulk of the touches since. Nine plays, 86 yards, 3 minutes, 9 seconds. Jared Brown perfect on the air on extra points. Old Dominion pretty darn good on this day. Old Dominion, a team few want to face. Lopsided lead. There are fans, and there are fans. It's 63-35. Old Dominion comfortably leading over Coastal Carolina. We have some finals. Overtime. App State goes down.
Wow, losing by a point. You wonder what took place there. In overtime, maybe failed two-point conversion attempt or blocked PAT. That stage of the game, and the number one seed North Dakota State on cruise control, 21-3 over South Dakota State.
Well, another thing you pointed out, New Hampshire goes down to Wofford. SoCon takes down the CAA. That means Old Dominion, which is leaving the league, was not allowed to receive the automatic berth this year by virtue of its defection that is imminent, is the last flag bearer for the Colonial Athletic Association.
They'll claim them now, won't they? They would definitely claim them now. But yeah, two CAA teams down this early in the tournament. Can't recall last time that happened.
And remember, they've expanded the tournament several times in recent years, and it wasn't that long ago the CAA would make up five bids in a 16-team total field.
Yeah, just a season ago when the first expansion went to the 20 teams, the CAA received five teams in there. Many people thought that was undeserved, and when you look at it, there was no team from the CAA that made it to the finals. So I think the selection committee took that into account this year when they only allowed three teams in, and it seems like they got it right because there's only one team remaining.
The CAA was the dominant force at year after year, a team in that championship. Delaware winning it in 03, James Madison 04. CAA team fell to App State 05, 06, 07, including the Joe Flacco-led Blue Hens in that 07 campaign. On the run, Hillary slides near midfield. He keeps fighting. He's been a warrior today, and these Chanticleers have no reason to hang their heads. They played as well as they could with a patchwork squad that was put together with tape and ice. And hung with ODU today.
Tape and ice.
He needs some ice. When you got bruises like that, my friend.
And the score won't reflect it. The final score probably will not. But they gave they pushed ODU to the limit. And all the way up to the third quarter.
Chris Presley, the catch. Yeah, you're right. This final score, whatever it winds up being, will in no way be indicative of what this game was. And I think many of these fans that are now beginning to leave and spill out to celebrate in the parking lot had their pulse racing quite a bit during the course of this afternoon into evening.
Yeah, particularly when they were able to tie the game in the third quarter. Give credit to ODU, though, with the resolve to withstand that and then to put this game away.
Fade toward the end zone. Knock it down. Aaron Evans. So Old Dominion, which won one playoff game last year, beat Norfolk State, and then lost to Georgia Southern. If the score that we've seen the last few times we've checked holds up, we'll get a rematch with the Eagles. It's under 3 minutes to go at Statesboro. Georgia Southern up on Central Arkansas by 8. Second down and fade to nobody.
And if that matchup were to occur, we talked about how Georgia Southern was able to rack off 600 yards, and Coach Wilder took that to heart. I mean, he actually went there and studied the triple option. He said, we don't see many teams in our league that do it, but we want to be better prepared for it if we do have only a week to prepare for playing a triple option team, whether that be Wofford or whether that's Georgia Southern. So we'll see if all the offseason work they did versus the triple option will pay off.
Hillary sacked. Greg Wilkins, the linebacker, all-conference performer, the fifth-year senior. At Georgia Southern, while it's incredibly explosive, at the same time, it's a high-risk, high-reward offense. They do put it on the ground a lot this year. Jeff Munkin has been very vocal that he's been upset about their turnovers, their fumbles. Hillary one-on-one, left side, incomplete. And it's such a contrast in styles, the very heavy air attack of Old Dominion and the ground efforts of Georgia Southern. We'll step aside when we come back. Conclusion of this affair, 63-35, ODU. Welcome on back, Norfolk, Virginia. New quarterback in the game, Nate Ong, the redshirt senior, JUCO transfer out of Palomar Junior College. His first action, he's joined by freshman Harvey Taylor at running back. Taylor gets the carry on first down. Nate Ong got some interest from Louisiana Tech, Iowa State, Akron, and his alma mater. Also the alma mater of Tom Dempsey of the legendary 63-yard field goal with the Saints. And ESPN's own Tom Luganville, who we saw at halftime.
That's right, little Southern California guy. San Diego type area. San Diego area.
And with Nate Ong in, you can see the smile on the face of Heinicke. That means he's out after 6 touchdowns in the air, 2 on the ground. He accounts for 8 TDs today. He's a sophomore.
Now, it's unfortunate for him that all the ballots for the Peyton Award have already been turned in. I mean, I'm sure this is probably one of the more impressive performances of the 3 finalists that are out there. For those that don't know, they actually, all your ballots are in already. So this performance is impressive, and he'll take the team victory all day. But wow, if this could have been during the ballots had not had to been turned in already, this probably would have put him over the top and clinched the Peyton Award for him.
Began the day leading the country in yards this year, now second behind Steve McNair all time. Gave him 41 touchdowns in the air. The man who set new Division I records for total offense and passing yards in that 64-61 defeat of New Hampshire. Keeps adding to the legend. And off for no gain. So Heinicke gets another shot at Georgia Southern. One team, one year, one shot. The slogan for this year's squad trying to win a national championship. And his head coach, Bobby Wilder, who cherry-picked tidbits of information from Coastal Carolina. He said within 2 months of getting the head coaching job, he met with Jim Leavitt, then the head coach at South Florida, and David Bennett, who was the head coach at Coastal, led the Shots to 3 Big South titles in his first 4 years. His timeout's called by Old Dominion. The biggest advice that he got from Bennett, avoid mass exodus. Bennett brought in 18 players, had them sit out, not play before the program started, then brought in 18 freshmen and saw 36 players that were the core of his program leave. So he advised him, go out and bring in some junior college players, and that was a piece of advice that was reinforced by Bruce Stewart, former director of basketball operations at Coastal Carolina, who was then handed the task of, here, put together a football program for the college, did it incredibly well. And based upon their conversations a couple of months later, he poached Bruce Stewart and brought him over to be an associate AD for football at Old Dominion.
When they say imitation is the greatest form of flattery, I think that's what they've done, and they came up with a good product. And I was just going through some notes and talk about Taylor Heinicke and what he's done. But he's on the heels of eclipsing some of the records by Steve Air McNair. How phenomenal was it, Steve? Air McNair counted for 5,700 yards in one season. And that's only with 12 games. Now, Heinicke's going to have more games. McNair threw for 4,863 yards.
Old Dominion's second punt of the day. Mastro Mateo, a yard on the return. Here's a look at Taylor Heinicke, first half and second stanza.
First half showing off the athleticism, the ability to create something when nothing was there at all, running the football when it wasn't there, taking off, realizing the defense was focused on the secondary receivers, but not the quarterback position. Then the second half, he came out and said, we're going to throw the football around. Equal distribution accounted for 5 touchdowns in the second half alone. Most want that in a game, they would be happy, but Taylor Heinicke, he basically showed off the full arsenal here tonight.
Hillary, a little option pitch to height. Not a whole lot. Well, to go back to your point about McNair, though, not only did he do it in a more compressed schedule, but Heinicke has the luxury of the spread being en vogue. It's a popular thing. It's commonplace. You're talking about back in a time when running the football was a much bigger part of the game.
Still the key. You know, and I played against Steve McNair in college. Well, we had a nice rivalry, but neither one of us had the ability to come out and start the game in four wide receiver sets with one running back. It was always, I had a fullback and a tailback. And in today's college football landscape, you know, these numbers, you're going to start to see the numbers continue to get higher and higher. But I will say this, what I like about Taylor Heinicke compared to some of the other spread offenses out there, you didn't see him throw a number of passes behind the line of scrimmage. You know, they throw the ball downfield. Great intermediate pass game, but when you come up, they go over the top. So often now you see quarterbacks just throwing the ball sideways behind the line of scrimmage and getting these inflated numbers, where I give credit to Old Dominion. They don't do a lot of that. They do it at times, but that's not the main staple of their offense.
Well, there have been some FCS quarterbacks through the years that have gone on to bigger and better on Sundays. Steve McNair, how about Joe Flacco? Now star with the Baltimore Ravens, coming up on a contract here. And Jay Walker, of course, you had some time in the NFL. You were a draft pick.
Yep. I didn't make the 4,000-yard club, though. My little 3,600 yards, still upset with my fullback. And just imagine, you know, my senior year, I threw for 26 touchdowns, which was big back then. And I had a fullback that had 20 rushing touchdowns. So I'm still mad at Rupert Grant.
You know, another wrinkle to the spread game as well that comes about today that I'm not sure many fans enjoy and Old Dominion does not like and does not employ. Your thoughts on the volume of teams that the entire squad looks to the sideline and they try to adjust to defense repeatedly.
Yeah, I mean, you want to give yourself an advantage to call a play that has the highest chance of success, but it's different. I mean, it's changing. I mean, I've talked to offensive coordinators around the country where they had to teach a quarterback. I could not believe this. They had to teach a quarterback how to call a play in the huddle because they never called a play in high school in a huddle. I mean, that's like the key. I could never imagine that. I mean, it surprised me to think you've got kids coming out today that have never taken a snap underneath the center and have never called a play in a huddle in their post-football career, high school on up. And that's like, wow. But it just tells you how things are changing. I don't think it's going anywhere anytime soon.
Drop for a loss in the backfield. Well, the other additive to that, Jay, is then when these guys get to the NFL, they got to learn quite a bit in a short span of time.
They do. Robert Griffin III had to make the adjustment. He's done a pretty good job, so I think you'll start to see more of it. But the NFL is all about having a marquee tailback, and spread hasn't not shown to be conducive to having a power running game behind him.
So your final score, Old Dominion wins it 63-35. ODU is on to the quarterfinals. Here are the rest of the games. We'll get a rematch with Georgia Southern here in Norfolk while Wofford awaits the final, likely to face the defending national champ in North Dakota State. So for Jay Walker, I'm John Sadak saying so long from Norfolk, Virginia. Our final score, Old Dominion 63, Coastal Carolina 35. To watch this entire game on replay, as well as other games on our ESPN networks, log on to WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN.